if you'll give me your attention, it is 1 o'clock. It is time to start the Budget and Finance Committee meeting, or call the Budget and Finance Committee meeting to order. The first item on the agenda is consideration of minutes from March the 8th, 2018. If everyone's had an opportunity to look at those, any corrections, additions, deletions, or anything? If not, I'll entertain a motion.
Move for approval.
Second.
Proper motion and second. All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Second item on the agenda, consideration of amendment number one to contract 2013-0043, an interlocal agreement between Williamson County, Tennessee and the City of Franklin for the City of Franklin, Tennessee for the collection of property taxes.
Yes, sir. This item is asking for your consideration for a 5-year extension of an agreement that was entered into in 2013 between Williamson County and the City of Franklin, Tennessee, in which the County Trustee's Office collects property taxes on behalf of the City of Franklin. This is a convenient service for our property owners and our residents. They receive one bill, are able to pay the County Trustee, and then she remits those funds to us. There is no cost increase. There is a charge of $4 per parcel. It's the same cost that was in the original agreement. For this current fiscal year, we paid the County Trustee $125,148. There's a slight increase only when the numbers of parcels slightly increase. So staff does recommend an extension of this agreement.
This has been a great deal for the city, the county, and the taxpayers, our citizens overall. It really has streamlined the process, and as Christine shared with you, at a really pretty affordable level in terms of cost to the city, has helped our folks focus on other customer service work that we do with our citizens. So we strongly recommend that we continue this arrangement, and it's a great collaboration between the city and county.
I've certainly enjoyed the service, being able to go to one spot, pay the tax, and I'm sure that's what the rest of the taxpayers of Franklin are experiencing. So I would wholeheartedly recommend that we enter into another. We got 3 5-year agreements.
It's actually an extension of the 2013. Okay. The 2013 agreement allowed for an extension, and actually the County Trustee approached us because she was very willing to continue the arrangement.
So let's see, our motion would be to recommend this to the board.
Recommend to the full board or consent agenda? Or
I think consent this agenda. Is consent worthy. Yes.
Okay.
Thank you.
Proper motion. Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Item number three, consideration of draft resolution 2018-28, authorizing and directing the Industrial Development Board of the City of Franklin to prepay a portion of its taxable rate tax increment revenue refunding bond series 2015A variable rate. I should have looked. Is the mayor here? The mayor read that.
Well, you know, for the next meeting, we can lengthen
okay,
it.
All right.
So he can read,
all right.
Yeah.
I'm glad that you got some of that.
I would ask Vicki to help me. I do. There's a presentation attached to this item. And this is very similar to a presentation that was made to this committee last August. And what we are doing at this point, actually this year we're doing this a little bit earlier in the calendar year. Staff has reviewed the revenues, the property tax revenues in which were collected in the tax increment financing district, and comparing those to debt service that has been paid on the 2015 TIF bonds. And if I'm certainly will recall in 2017, we recommended a prepayment. In 2017, we recommended a prepayment of $700,000. And that was the first time that we had recommended prepayment of those bonds that were issued for the TIF district. We, now that we have our procedures down, all of our steps that are in accordance with affecting a prepayment, we're here just a little bit earlier because we believe we can affect this prepayment by the end of June. So the presentation's it's a similar format as you saw last year, but it's going to be an update of the valuations and as well as the revenues and expenses in the TIF district, and then we'll conclude with a recommendation to prepay in this case $600,000 of the 2015 TIF bonds, and the resolution that was attached is the same format that the board approved last year. We'll start off with this year the TIF district valuation. We have an increase of 8.9% over the previous year. This year's a little bit better reflection. It's a little easier reflection of the valuations within the TIF district. The previous year had been a reassessment year, a reappraisal year for the county. And when you have a county-wide reappraisal, of course, there is certainly always new growth. We talk about it every board meeting, new growth in this area. However, when you have county-wide reappraisal, that kind of adds noise to what truly is the increase in the growth in the district. So there was a significant year-over-year increase between 17 and 16. 2018 is a if you want to call it a regular year for property assessment, and we had an 8.9% or $39.2 million increase in the assessed value within the TIF district. And of course, the assessed value, just to be clear, that's based on the assessment ratios. So that is not full appraised value, that's assessed value. And assessed value is actually what the taxes are based upon in the district.
That's 40% in this district, is that right?
Pretty much most is commercial, so you'll have real property is at 40% if it's commercial. If we could go on to the next slide. And very, very similar. We have a just under a 9% increase because assessed value is what we bill taxes on. So we did have an increase of 8.9% in the billed property taxes year over year, a little over $200,000. We actually, for the first time, crossed the $2 million in revenue, property tax revenue in the district at $2,003,000. And of course, we continue to include the historical values that you can see from the growth of the district has been significant over time.
Yeah, and we do want to say that the reason that we're having to repay some things that the city has advanced to pay on this is because right after we started this, we had the downturn, and we really didn't grow as quickly as we thought, but it's certainly
yes, ma'am. That's certainly an excellent point, that the timing of the original bond issue, which was a 2005 bonds that we now call the 2015 bonds because they were refinanced in 2015, that the timing resulted in the early years, the growth in valuation, as well as the growth in revenues, but it was not as strong as we would have liked. But certainly we continue to see growth, and that is the 8.9% year-over-year growth is that properties that are developing within the TIF district, and we certainly have some more development within that district that we will anticipate in the next couple of years will be added to the tax rolls.
So we billed 156,000 in 2008 and 2 million.
Yeah. Over 2 million. Yeah,
that's
this
right.
Last
yes, sir.
Year.
That's good.
Yeah, this year.
That's very good.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Well, wait, it wasn't good at the start, but it's very good now.
Yeah.
We remember the start.
Yes.
The next chart is a summary of the financial results for the district for fiscal year 2018. Of course, we have not completed this fiscal year, but property taxes are due at the end of February. We will be conducting our audit at the conclusion of the year, but we do believe that we have enough information to present to you a summary of the financial results. Just over $2 million, we'll call it $2 million of billed property taxes. It is certainly our county trustee does a very effective job in collecting property taxes, but we'll estimate a 3% uncollected taxes and appeals to be reasonable in estimating a property taxes net of uncollected taxes and appeals of $1.9 million. We did pay interest in principal on the bonds in 2018 of $1.3 million for net property taxes less debt service expense of $627,520. And I will point out, of course, the estimate on uncollected taxes and appeals. There is a process in Tennessee, and almost everything is eventually collected, but the county trustee will go through that process. And there is a small amount of property taxes which are collected in future years, and the trustee we'll certainly do that in accordance with state law.
Is just a little question, any penalty for the collection of the late, let's say you appeal and you lose, do you just pay the taxes? Or do you have to, would you pay the taxes and a small penalty? Because if that was the case, I'd appeal all the time. If you really want to delay the payment for 6 months or whatever it is, yeah.
Well, one of the challenges or one of the realities in on commercial appeals is the property owner will have significant legal expenses for appealing, because in Tennessee, a larger commercial appeal typically bypass, the County Board of Equalization will waive that up to the higher level, to the state. So there's really not a representing yourself.
Okay.
Like a resident may represent himself or herself and go to the County Board of Equalization, but in this district where it's commercial primarily, an appeal has to be fairly well thought through. You know, they still can lose, and they may have to pay some sort of a penalty, but it does take some thought, because they are incurring expenses beyond the cost of the appeal, but appeals do happen, and commercial appeals can take 2 to 3 years to work their way through the system. But a typical just late payment, the county trustee, she'll work through, and there will be penalties collected if someone, property owner just simply pays late, and she was already into that process for the payments that were due the end of February. So we do have a staff that we are identifying $627,520 that would be remaining that could be used toward repayment of the TIF bonds. This is at the point, the same time last year that I pointed out, of course, that and you all both, a couple of our aldermen just brought up that we did loan ourselves, essentially we loaned ourselves money in the early years of this bond issue, in which there was not sufficient revenues within the district to repay the debt service. And in accordance with the documents for the original bonds, the city will be repaid before the TIF district ends. And we've made it a staff recommendation to recommend that we essentially go ahead as we begin having additional revenues and prepay the bond, which we took out with BB&T. That's our first priority. Mm-hmm. And that at the end of that repayment, we'll pay the city back. There is accounting that we do every year for that loan. It is disclosed. And we actually have to book interest based on the rate of the bonds to ourselves. So we are following, we do have two different pieces of an essentially debt to repay, but we have chosen to propose that we repay BB&T first. And that's the same recommendation that we have this year that you enacted last year, in which we do want to repay in whole $100,000 increments, so we'll round down, recommend repaying $600,000, and anything that would be remaining at the end of the fiscal year would go toward repaying ourselves back, which at the end of this past year was $2,594,124. So this is just an estimate, because we certainly are estimating what our uncollected taxes are, but we are recommending to move forward with prepaying $600,000 of that 2015 bond issue to BB&T.
I think you said that would reduce our time by, I don't have that in front of me. I think.
Yes, ma'am. What we did is, if you'll recall, that the 2015 bonds are structured, there's a fixed rate bond that we're repaying right now. When the fixed rate bond ends in 2020, we begin paying down the variable rate note, which originally went out to 2025. These bonds actually we do pay principal every quarter, so we were allowed to take off the $700,000 that we prepaid last year, came off the back end. We just continued to walk up, and the bond documents gave us that flexibility. So we are prepaying on the variable rate piece. So our regular repayment is in the fixed rate right now. We're paying interest on the variable, but this prepayment, and there's no penalty to repay early. So there's no penalty for that, but we are prepaying by taking off the back end of the variable rate piece. And so we'll continue. This chart shows that in fiscal year 2025, after we would prepay the $600,000 down this year, we'll be, as you can see, the stair step, instead of being level, it's now going, it's falling off pretty very quickly there at the end, because we've been prepaying off the back end of those 2015 bonds.
Christine, what's that variable rate set on?
It's LIBOR plus 75 basis points. And it's an excellent point that last year, Alderman Speedy wasn't with us last year, but we were looking at 1.8%. LIBOR has gone up.
Yep.
And we're now looking at 2.63% on the variable rate piece. So that has been a change from the interest rate assumption's been changed from last year. And that's another reason why we wanted to go ahead and present this to you, is if we were going to go ahead and plan to prepay, let's go ahead and prepay before we have another interest payment on the variable rate piece. Then the question that we talked about last year at some length, and at this point it is a projection. You're asking to yourself, when do we anticipate paying off the 2015 bonds? By nature, we're finance people. We're pretty conservative on revenues, and so you're asking folks who like to know the answers to questions that we're talking when it comes to growth. And the timing of growth is a little bit challenging for us, because certainly we get very good information from Vernon Girth and Lynn Osland in our Building and Neighborhood Services on permits and development. But actually, when a property goes on to the tax rolls is a little bit of a mystery. The exact timing is a little bit of a mystery. So, when I look at what we have anticipated in the district, likelihood of maybe being a little bit conservative about when it hits the tax rolls, but trying to be reasonable as well. I would give the information that I believe that we should be paid off on the 2015 TIF bonds in 2022, but we still have to repay ourselves back for that loan amount from the early years. So I think 2023 is a reasonable expectation. And that's assuming growth that we know about. We also have a reassessment coming up in this period, and I believe that's kind of what puts us.
Oh my!
Because we saw what happened. Mm-hmm. We had about a 50% growth. When the countywide reassessment occurred and it increased valuations in the whole district, it's in 21.
It's every 5 years.
Okay. So.
Yeah. 21's the next big one.
So I see what you mean. Yeah. That
and
make a difference.
And certainly. I'm not projecting the same level of increase that we had this last time, because that is assuming some what valuations are in the future. But we will have some sort of a increase in the district in valuations due to reassessment, separate from the growth that we see in permits that have already been filed. So we're still looking at essentially the same time frame as being able to pay off the bonds a couple years earlier than the original amortization. And I think that's something that the board knew was coming, but now that we actually are starting to be able to prepay, you're getting a better indication of when that will be. Eric, do you have any additional comments?
No, I think this is the same strategy we followed a year ago. We want to stay the course on that. I think there's clearly wisdom in paying off your debt before you pay yourself back. Mm-hmm. And you see these projections, which we think are pretty conservative, but it's not that far off that these will be the TIF bonds will be retired, we pay ourselves back, and then this becomes an additional revenue source in our general fund. Mm-hmm. Which is a nice benefit.
Indeed.
And so you see that today is around $2 million. It will naturally grow over time as well, so that will be a significant additional funding source. Mm-hmm. For us around that 2022-2023 mm-hmm. time frame. Mm-hmm. I would also add this nicely coincides with a structural spike that we have in 2024 in debt service. Mm-hmm. Just the way some of the debt was structured, especially around the police building. Mm-hmm. We have just a step up in 2024, and then it drops off. It was just how it was structured at the time. Mm-hmm. And so having that coming online and the time that we are also paying ourselves back actually nicely coincides with that 1 year blip in our debt service schedule. So I think that's something for us just to keep in mind as these pieces come together, that we need to manage that step for that 1 year. And as we look at whatever else we choose to do down the line related to any other debt financing, that we just keep that in mind as well. That's just something we're going to have to manage.
Good point, because when I looked at the debt service, and I saw those that we were not paying any principal on at all.
It's a different structure than we tend to use.
So the timing may be extremely good, as you say.
The and finally, the next steps, and this was the part of the process that we were able to work through last year, and we're coming back to you knowing how this process exactly will work. And typically on refinancing, because you're most likely having to borrow money at lower rates to pay off rather than just taking cash to pay off debt, there's a lot less steps, and this is a nice, very clean way to defease bonds. But we do have a short resolution. That's why it's a one-page resolution instead of the books of paperwork that you typically see for anything connected to bonds. So there is an approval of a resolution which authorizes the Industrial Development Board to redeem early a portion of the 2015 bonds. At that point, it becomes administrative. Our staff works with the attorney for the IDB as well as the bank to set the actual date, and we clearly believe that we can get this completed before the end of June, once the full board approves the resolution allowing us to do so. There is no prepayment penalty due to BB&T. There are no issuance. There's no cost to do this transaction. We as staff administer this process, and there is no further board action required to reduce the loan amount due to the city. That if there's a small amount that is remaining, that is done as part of the audit process. So the approval of the resolution to repay the debt is the only formal board action required for this process.
I move we recommend to the board that we do these things that have just been discussed.
Proper motion. Second. All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Do you want this on the voting session of the board, or do you want this on the...
I think so. I mean, we walked through this last time. When we did it the first time in the fall last year, we did do a presentation at work session. I'd kind of look at your guidance as to whether you think it's needed to walk through this again with everybody, or we can put it... I mean, it's the same strategy and direction we had last year related to this. I think it's an important story to tell in terms of
that's
the progress.
Right.
I'd follow your guidance on if you want us to run through this, we can do it in maybe a little shorter order because we've already been through it with a group of you, but however you'd like to proceed.
You can go to a short presentation.
Short presentation.
Yes.
Okay.
But good news.
Good news, exactly.
Good news. Okay.
Exactly.
Yeah. We'd be happy to do that.
Item 4, budget presentation, Franklin Transit Authority.
We have Stanton with us from Franklin Transit to walk through their request and budget presentation for this year.
Well, thank you for having me. Again, my name is Stanton Higgs. If you don't know who I am, I'm a Business Development Operations Director at TMA. I did want to let you know that Debbie Henry, who is our executive director, wanted me to pass on. She apologizes for not being here today. Some of you know she's gone through some major surgery, and she's supposed to be working out right now, getting rehab. So
she got watching this on TV or anything?
She might be. You know? We're streaming live on Facebook, so she
might. Well, then I'd say she probably is. So I'll be careful, more careful on what I say. I did also want to mention that this presentation and this budget has been presented to the Franklin Transit Authority, and I bring it to you as a recommended from the Franklin Transit Authority for us to present to you. So. I'll go to the next slides here. We'll just push right through that one, go to the next one. So the mission of the Franklin Transit is connecting people, places, providing efficient, safe, and affordable transportation. Mobility and connectivity is really, I think, what everyone's focusing on in transit. We're just a part of that mobility and connectivity, and for particular type of folks that enjoy taking transit and find a different way to get to and from places without using their automobile. What we currently do as our responsibilities, we run a planning, operations, and management of the small urban public transit system. We operate 6 days a week. We take Sunday off, and 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. is our operating hours. We run two types of service. One is our fixed route service, which is basically same route, same times every day, with a little bit of an altered schedule on Saturday. And then we have a demand response, which is a reservation. People can call in, first come, first serve. And that runs from 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. also, and we call that the TOD, Transportation on Demand. TMA is who I work for. We're a nonprofit. Here we run, manage different kinds of transportation programs throughout the region, and Franklin Transit being one of them, so it helps us utilize some of our contacts and some of our staff to be able to kind of add to each of our different programs that we do. We do regional van pools, we're regional park and ride lots, and car share, carpooling, those kind of things. And we also have a TDM programs where we work with corporations throughout the region, helping them help organize and better plan their employees' rides to work. I'll just mention that too, because we're real thrilled. We're up to 4 van pools right up the street at Columbia with Lasco. Lasco has really worked hard with us for the van pool, so that's close to about 45 people that are using the van pool service, kind of overseen by Franklin Transit, getting to work every day. Those folks are coming from Columbia, and then we got another 40 people that are coming all the way from Clarksville to work at the IRS in Cool Springs. 3 of them are IRS and 1 is Social Security. So, but that's a long haul every day, Clarksville to Cool Springs. And there's more of those people out there. So as part of what we do, we're trying to kind of use both Franklin Transit and our other commuting programs to kind of help people get to and from work. The highlights of this year, mainly through the approvals that your board gave to us last year, is we were able to restructure the Franklin Transit fixed routes. Up until that time, our demand response and our fixed route was basically about 50-50 as far as our resources. And this was a movement to put much more effort, more infrastructure, more resources at our fixed routes. The highlights of it was it to extend out into the Carruthers corridor with fixed route service to better help the companies out there as we began to develop kind of a longer-term strategy for circulation of employees and neighbors and now college students out there to be able to move around that corridor, depending on what we do with maybe additional services coming in from outlying areas for commuters and things like that. So you had to lay that groundwork. The other thing that was a tremendous improvement, we've been on 1 hour intervals. We've been on kind of like long clock routes. All the routes now are basically very direct, and you got a bus coming in both directions. And so if you want to go one direction, you got on one side of the street. You want to go the other direction, you get on the other side of the street. We doubled the amount of stops that you could get on, and that basically cut your waiting from 60 minutes to 30 minutes. Mm-hmm. And so there's a bus coming to that stop every 30 minutes. And the other thing that really does is if you're out at Fieldstone Farms, for example, and you just want to come downtown, now it's about 10 to 12 minutes to get downtown. And when you're ready to go home, you don't have to go around the clock. You just go to the other side of the street, and you'll be home in about 10 or 12 minutes. So the delivery of the service has improved greatly this year. We're pleased to have that all kind of working. We got a lot more to do, but that was, I guess, our highlights for this year. The last thing is the building there at Columbia Avenue. It has become our transfer location, so we have 2 main routes. And when folks want to go from one side of the town off the red route and go all the way to Cool Springs or Williamson Medical Center, they used to have to get off at the factory. Mm-hmm. And now everybody comes into our place. So it's been a lot of fun. They're still scared sometimes to walk into our building. Even when it's raining, I'm like, you want to come in? And they're like, nah, we'll just wait out here. But I think that's a really neat part of what's happened. I've been in the bus business a long time, and the more we know our customers, the more they're comfortable around us. It's just a nice thing to have. It's a beautiful building, and I'm really pleased that that's there for them now to be able to come in and out and wait for the bus. In regards to the breakdown, not a lot has changed. This is the thing that we have to work on the most. Our passenger trip count is relatively similar to it was last year, about 90,000 passenger trips. The breakdown of who's using the vehicle and the transit service is very similar to last year and the year prior. About 55% are using it to get to and from work. 20% are students. These are for high school and college for the most part. 10% medical, and then 10% are event-oriented, so Main Street Festival, Pumpkin Fest. You'll see a big hit every once in a while based on what festivals are going on in Franklin with transit counts, and that's mainly because we always try to assist, and we're very appreciative of the city and the festival itself because they incorporate using Franklin Transit for park and ride shuttles so people aren't all having to come downtown to try to find parking, and we just, again, try to improve the mobility. Then 5% of these are folks that are just taking it to go someplace, go to the bowling alley, go to the mall, come down here downtown. Our organizational chart is there for you. Nothing for me to really say about that, but it's there. Next slide, the operational personnel budget. This represents the total dollar amount for anyone who is directly touching and directly getting paid through this budget for Franklin Transit. So this would include all of our full-time and part-time drivers. This would include all of our operational dispatch folks and for folks within our organization at TMA that have direct responsibility for managing or making sure the processes for Federal Transit Administration or Department of Transportation are being taken care of. The next slide. This is our highlights, and someone played a trick on me and took page 4 and 5 out of my presentation, so I'm going to do this. But I stole his notes and wrote it down. So we went over the highlights already, so I'm going to pass right past that. The operationals budgets, and there's a it's $2,371,385. We've included the previous figure that you saw of the $1.2 million. In that amount, just because in our brains, staff and drivers and things is part of our operational budget. So your total budget, including all personnel, is $2,371,385. That would include everything else in regards to fuel, insurance, all the things that it takes to operate a transit. Next slide. This is the kind of how we put it. Our template's just a little bit different than the city format, so Michael works with us. The additional dollars that are in the budget is a planning request of $137,500. And then we also have capital equipment budget of $400,000. We've put a little note there that these are funding mechanisms where 80% of the funds for these dollars are coming from federal programs and grants that we work with. 10% is given to us by the state of Tennessee, and the city's portion is 10%, which on the planning budget would be $13,750. And on the capital equipment budget, that's a mixture of equipment and IT equipment that we're looking to put in place would be $40,000. So the total, he switched my screens here, the total budget requests here for Franklin Transit budget is $2,908,885. That's a mixture of the total operational budget plus the additional amounts we just showed on the planning and the capital. The request from the city is $985,171. That represents about 34% of the total budget. We put a note here. Our main emphasis is we're very happy with the improvement that we have done as Franklin Transit on the delivery of the system. We've already began the process of RFPs for the IT side or the distribution, the way to kind of get involved with the folks. So we have a RFP that should hit the streets here pretty soon in regards to folks being able to do trip planning, being able to locate the bus on their devices that they're using. We're working currently with MTA, RTA, because they just put a large RFP, and we worked through the process on that for a payment processing over smartphones. Also, signage, more transit shelters, because although we have signs up, sometimes until you get something that's a little bit bigger than a sign, it doesn't register in anybody's head that, you know, there's something out here for me to take. That's our total request, I think. I will just say that as we move towards the end of this year and we kind of get everything taken care of, I don't think that our request of what we needed from the city last year, that we'll need that full amount. I think that budget amount last year was $842,000. I believe we'll come in about $100,000 less. The reason that is that once we got the approval to move ahead, there's a kind of a period of time where it takes to get everything in place, get drivers hired, things like that. So it wasn't because we did such an outstanding job of budgeting. It was just because it takes a little while to get things started. So we won't use the full $842,000 that we requested last year. We'll come in somewhere underneath that.
And I may just add to Stanton's point that is part of the accounting closeout for the year between our accounting staff and the staff at TMA is to wrap up the fiscal year for both sides, and we do make sure that we have that contribution amount that on our books as well as theirs. So we do identify what that final contribution amount is, which is less than appropriated there during the closeout for the fiscal year.
First of all, I just want to offer my sympathy for the loss of one of your colleagues.
Thank you.
Sudden loss of one of your colleagues who will be greatly missed with her contribution to us here in Franklin with the Franklin Transit Authority. You mentioned the commuter service that is bringing employees into Franklin from Clarksville, from Maury County, mm-hmm. in one of these little black vans. They're mm-hmm. taking cars off the road. Talk about that a little bit more.
Okay, so it's not necessarily officially a part of Franklin Transit, but it is overseen by Franklin Transit because they're a direct recipient of the federal funds that comes in for us to help manage that program. But it's called VanStar. Mm-hmm. Right. We're successful in some ways, and it's difficult when fuel's down, and I hate to say that it's good for business when fuel jumps 20 cents in the last week or so, because that hurts my pocketbook, but hurts us in other areas. But that's a service where we have about 70 vehicles that run throughout the county, not this county, excuse me, the nine counties around Davidson County, bringing people not just into Nashville. Quite a few people are going here into Williamson County. And so that's just part of the puzzle, right? There's no, you know, magic bullet for fixing transportation, transit, congestion. It takes about 10, 20, 30 different things, and that's part of what we do. And part of, again, where Franklin Transit becomes really, really important is we've had multiple studies and done a lot of surveying out at Cool Springs, because we need to kind of, as supply and demand meet, I don't think they've met yet, but when they meet, we want to be prepared to have services in place that are meeting the needs of the employees and whatever they might be. Some people don't have a good enough car, in this case, Lasco. They're coming from Columbia. Most of those folks, they're not making a ton of money, and they don't have cars that are going to drive 80 miles a day, 5 days a week, and keep them on the road. So for us to be able to give them a public transit van, could be a Toyota 7-passenger van or a Ford 10 or 15, and let those folks use that vehicle. They come on on TMA's insurance. We provide maintenance for those vehicles. That's a lifesaver. That's more than just transit. It's really job development, economic development. So we're real pleased with that program.
And the cost for that person, let's just say I'm in Columbia and I become one of those people who want to come up to Lasco to work, I'm out of what, about $10 a week or $40 a month?
So that particular distance, we do everything based on their on the commute miles, mm-hmm. and we factor a mileage price into it. Those folks are paying about $50 a month, so, you know, $12.50.
So if you had a car, you would be paying how much?
You'd be paying, depending on your car, you're going to be paying about 40, yeah. 50 bucks a week on fuel.
It's a good deal.
It's a great deal. It's a great deal.
Thank you.
I would mention, just so that you're aware of it, the additional dollars that we're really requesting comes down to two items. One's a revenue, one's an expense. One is a revenue item that, you know, the grants that we do or the dollars that we do get back from Washington are usually part of a analysis of ridership transit that's gone on within our region 2 years ago. So if ridership is down, they put in a kind of a program into the program of how they figure out expenses, revenue hours, vehicle miles, transit riders for a whole region. The region itself from 2016 received less money from Washington. That translated to about $63,000 less to Franklin Transit for this year. Mm-hmm. So that's a revenue reason that kind of came out of revenues that we had from previous year. And after running the fixture out service full year, I think we just have a better handle, plus a small increase for our drivers. It's always been an issue to try to keep our drivers competitive in a very competitive wage driver market. On the expense side, that would represent really the full difference between the request from last year and the request for this year.
And if I could say, the big jump last year was because you were doing all these
yes.
things that you've just talked about
yeah.
that you wanted to do.
Right.
So.
Right.
But
and our go ahead. Sorry. Sorry.
No, I'm sorry. Oh. Okay. You go ahead.
I was just going to say our big goal here is the. Every time we get a new rider get on the bus on Carruthers, I know it's a new rider.
That's a new rider.
That's a good thing. Where we're fighting right now is I'm hitting a target for what I believe is a good goal for us to for the additional dollars we meant to improve the system. I'll hit that number once every 10 days. So that's the good news, that I can hit it, right? The bad news is I want to hit it every day.
Yeah.
We just don't have that frequency that it's part of their daily life.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll get there with fixed route because that's kind of the way it works. That just becomes their pattern.
Mm-hmm.
So our goal right now is to bring the technology side to kind of help penetrate a market that doesn't really necessarily ride transit. They don't want to look at a map. They don't want to see the bus and go, I wonder if I can get on that. They want to be able to look in their hand and say, well, it's going to be here in 3 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
It's expensive
yes.
propositions
yeah.
to get done. It's not as simple as, well, let's go write an app. You know, these are expensive propositions to get everything to work properly. So we got it narrowed down pretty well, and hopefully we'll have that in place by the end of this year.
That will be helpful. First time I ever saw that was in New Orleans, and the people that were standing with us said, oh, I can tell you when it's going to be here.
Yeah.
You
mm-hmm.
know,
mm-hmm.
and that made a huge difference to us.
Alderman Martin.
I have residents in West Haven tell me that they need access to the trolley. A lot of seniors want to come to town, but with our parking issues and the lack of parking, a lot of seniors don't want to ride around all over town looking for a parking place and then walk four blocks to get to Main Street to either shop or have lunch, and they want to know why they can't have the trolley come by there. I thought it did, but they said on demand you have to schedule it 48 hours ahead of time, and you know you don't always want to do that, but if you know that the trolley's coming at 11 o'clock to this spot to take you to town, you might have more riders out there. Now, I have not heard a lot from Franklin Green or Willow Springs, but there are also seniors there who mm. might really
at
benefit
least one.
From this if it were available.
Mm-hmm.
What do you have to do to make that available to those neighborhoods?
Well, luckily, I just follow the orders of whoever tells me. I was just teasing. West Haven was included in one of the probable plans when we did the study about 2 years ago. Mm-hmm. They came up with a grand total of about five different options on when we restructured. At the time, the option of West Haven was on there. It did not, both by the consultant, and then when we went through public review, It did not supersede the restructuring of how we currently got restructured. When I remember back to what the proposals were, it kind of at least gave us a framework of going from step one, which is kind of where we're at right now. Step two, which was second most popular, just to be honest with you, was more of an express route that spent more time on 96, taking care of that area. And then number three was West Haven. We follow at the direction of the Franklin Transit Authority and the city. Whatever you guys tell us that you'd like to see put in place, we will put in place. I think as an alternative, I know it's difficult to plan ahead sometimes for the Todd service, but it still is a wonderful advantage that we have over every other city. I can tell you that Murfreesboro doesn't have it. Clarksville doesn't have it. I don't believe that Jackson, which is another one of the transit that runs regular transit, has it. We're the only city in Middle Tennessee that has this kind of demand response service. And then the only other thing, and I'm not going to promise this, but one of the other projects we work on is looking at the newest and latest that are coming out that we could potentially try to fund as a pilot project that might be very similar to Todd, but spontaneous, almost like a combination of Uber, Lyft, and public transit. Those are things that are on our radar. We just have to go out and then get funding for them and put those programs together. And if that's the case, then I think we could really take care of your folks out there, because you have to have a certain amount of demand to do that. So,
but it would also need to be, they would need to be educated there,
yeah.
You know, that it was available and they could take it to town for the day or the morning or whatever.
I agree, and I'll just put my plug in since she set me up. When we do these budgets, when we look at the ask and we look at all the costs that it takes operationally to run these budgets, when we start to cut, I can tell you exactly where we cut is on the outreach and on the marketing. So we're good with this. We got a lot to do, but as an educational, money well spent is effective outreach when we put these programs in place and marketing to find the new riders. Because for every new rider we bring onto the system that pays money, literally it takes money that you don't have to fund. So as we move forward in years to come, you know, I'd like to get to the point where we have very aggressive marketing campaigns to attract new riders or provide new service for the new types of systems we put out there, because every dollar they spend is going to be that dollar less that we have to come back to the city and say, hey, we need some more money. So that's kind of the goal.
Two comments. When I was at the Clay Center, Todd was used very much by the senior citizens coming from Fieldstone, wherever they were coming from, didn't matter, but they were coming to the Clay Center on Bridge Street. So that was being used. Go ahead.
Yeah, I guess comment, that family enjoyed the Holly Trolley, love that. But my question is around, the technology and the efficiency. I mean, are we able to start partnering with people like the Uber and the Lyft? I mean, I know I see a lot of the trolleys where it's, one person, two persons. Are we be better off with 6 to 8 person vans? And I guess also my other question would be, is the state and federal funding, are we kind of guaranteed to get that every year going forward?
You're not guaranteed anything, really. It's based on whatever president and whatever that policy is for transportation. Funding hasn't changed drastically over the years, but you know there are certain programs that could come or go depending on the administration in Washington, D.C. So we watch it very carefully. That's part of what TMA, does. It's a lot of work to stay over it. I think the other part of TMA that is helpful for Franklin Transit is we spend a lot of time with the best of the best around the country. I'll be going up to Columbus, Ohio for an IT symposium just on these subjects. I think to answer your question in regards to Uber and Lyft, in every kind of new thing that might be happening in San Francisco or Washington, D.C. in regards to transit, we know these folks. In this case, I don't believe it's wise to be first in, because it's not always a good thing to be the first one that comes out and tries to do some sort of technology. what you see in the paper and what you see on the news, and I'd be happy to spend plenty of time with any of you that wants to talk about it, is always the good news. I can show you just as many failed kind of projects that have happened that have been very expensive for cities, transit agencies, and just because I've been in the transportation business, in the end, you know, you got to figure out a way to pay for this transportation. Uber, as powerful as they seem to be, I have some serious concerns on how they're going to make it. Their ability, in my opinion, still just holding on. If they can get the automated vehicles, they're going to make it. Otherwise, they're losing hundreds of billions of dollars. In anything we do, we look for what we think is sustainable, that's going to be good for our system and for the city. But we are talking to all of them and trying to look for the right model that we think might be able to work. Because once you give it to the people, you certainly don't ever want to take it away. They don't like that. So we got to make sure that what we give them we can sustain, afford, and that it's going to work. And that company will be around. A lot of these IT companies, they're new. We'd like to find that middle ground of somebody that's been around a little while and we feel comfortable with the sustainability of their company.
Thank you. That's
I just have a question.
Okay.
Because somebody asked me just very recently, how did they get information about Todd? Do they just go on your website or?
They go on our website or they can call us and talk to us.
In other words, they can just call.
We have really nice people that answer the phone and and we'll go through everything with them on how we can help them.
Good. Thank you.
To say, call 1-800 now.
It's our phone numbers are on all the buses.
On the bus, okay.
And on their website, so they're they can call us. But we have one person. His name is Mike, and he's a wonderful guy. And he sits there all day long and talks to customers and makes reservations for them.
Great, thank you.
Thanks, Dan.
Thank you,
Chairman. If I could make one comment.
Yes, Mayor.
The fact that now 55% of your ridership is are people going to work. It used to be the bulk of the rides were going to medical. So, you know, that shows continued improvement in the program and, you know, it has some economic benefit to be getting people to work. So congratulations on good work.
And you had 20% going to school, so you got 75% going to a job or to education. So that's an important role.
And that's also helpful to the businesses because they have people that they can hire that they might not have been able to get to come.
Item 5. Thank you again.
You dismissed.
Item 5, the budget presentation for the Marriott Cool Springs Conference Center.
And we have some of our new team at the Cool Springs Conference Center. We'll let Michael Bennett, who's joined us also from the city of Cincinnati, so that works out every once in a while when somebody comes from there, these parts. Hopefully it'll work well for him. But we want to welcome Michael and the rest of the team at Marriott and our partners in the conference center operations. So
you don't hold that against him.
Yeah, don't hold it against him. I hear it can work out, so yeah.
Thank you so much, and thank you for making me feel welcome to Franklin, and look forward to being a part of the community, so very exciting. I brought Randy and Andy with me because I've only been here 2 weeks, so I figured they know the conference center much better than I do. But
you had to
yeah, that's so right, so that's right. So I think we got the outline there, and so kind of just I'm sure many of you already know the summary of the convention center, the conference center. It's connected to the Marriott Hotel, built in 1999. We just went through a major renovation in 2015. I think it looks great, my personal opinion. We have connected to the conference center's 297 guest rooms with 3 suites, so 300 rooms total. 29,000 square feet of very flexible meeting space, a ballroom that has space up for 1,100 guests. 2018, we did almost 200,000 covers or guests with a combined average check of $22. We've done almost a thousand events with over 4,000 functions with those events. We have a very healthy environment. Business has been pacing up almost 6% or $150,000 over the same time last year. A lot of that is not necessarily covers, but more just price increase, supply and demand, obviously, so we can inch up the pricing.
Of course, group is a major key contributor to our revenue at the Conference Center. Our group nights, group room nights are pacing flat year over year, but as we said, we've been able to increase the pricing, so that's helped. There is a, most of our business in that we've seen the increase coming in is through our associations and also short-term corporate group. The only kind of concern that we throw out there is as coming new to Nashville, but we, you know, I kind of got to see it from afar. Definitely Nashville is on fire now with supply growing downtown, even in the Franklin area. And certainly a lot of that supply downtown has significant meeting space as well. And so we're not seeing that. We don't know the impact of it yet, but certainly it is, we, you know, as that push and coming out to this area is become less and less as those room nights come online. So also moving on to the relationship to the city, you know, the hotel is managed by both the center and the hotel are managed by Davison Hotels, which I've been a part of for almost 25 years now. We've managed the facility we took over in July 2014. The hotel is owned by Crow Holdings out of Dallas, and of course the city and county own the Conference Center. So I'll kind of turn it over to Randy to talk about the allocation and how that is split out a little more detail. So
yeah, I'm not sure how in depth we've gone into this in the past, but just so everyone's aware, the Conference Center and hotel revenues are not shared. Revenue generated at the hotel stays in the hotel. Revenue generated at the Conference Center stays there, but the expenses are split. A lot of the expenses are split on a total revenue basis, percentage of revenue. So typically, or on average, the hotel generates about 70% of the revenue. So 70% of the expenses for administrative in general, repair and maintenance, utilities, IT, things like that are split on that basis. Sales is, you know, we're generating sales for both entities, so that's always been a 50-50 split. Catering and event management is 100% to the Conference Center, and it doesn't say it on your handout, but I think it's worth mentioning that the rooms department is 100% to the hotel. So anything front desk related, housekeeping, etc., there is no charge to the Conference Center for that. And then the food and beverage revenues or food and beverage expenses are split on a percentage of revenue basis just for food and beverage. So that's how that works.
Yep.
Andy.
Just looking at the, looking at the last three-year financial summary, 2016-2017, revenues were $6.9 million. The net profit was $534,000. In 2016, the hotel portion finished its renovation. Conference Center was done in August of 15, and in January of 16, the hotel finished their portion. There was a little bit of a ramp-up period, but you could see going into 17 and 18, it really paid off. A lot of the groups that we get book 1, 2, 3 years out, and when they came and saw the new product, they really liked it, and that's why we're seeing the increase in revenues for 17 and 18. Projected revenues for the remainder of this fiscal year, $7.4 million. It's up $426,000 to the current budget, and net profit is $752,000, which is up $324,000 to the current budget. And then looking forward to 18-19, revenues slightly up, $7.6 million with net profit of $805,000. I think Mike had mentioned it earlier that the growth that we're anticipating coming into 18 and 19 is mainly going to be due to price increases. Hotel runs an average 80% occupancy, so we're getting to reach that max occupancy of what can generate additional revenue for the Conference Center.
So we are looking at a 3% increase in revenue still. We even know that we are, you know, from an occupancy standpoint, we're pretty maxed out. But as Andy said, we'll mix some sales and get, you know, make sure we get better business in as we take that with the supply and demand. So Little more notes is that, you know, if we're looking at the current year revenue, and there is no really revenue generators entering the market, nothing major at this point that's going to make a difference or leaving as far as we know. Based on current pace, we anticipate, again, the slight growth just through mixing of revenue or menu pricing. Again, we've reached our capacity for the most part in group. We can tweak a little bit, but that's not where our major growth comes from. I've already mentioned, our concerns about the supply in downtown Nashville. We've already seen that not really affecting us as much as it used to, I guess, historically. And also note that in 2017-18, the Renaissance Hotel in downtown was closed. Their meeting space was under renovation, so that created a little more demand for us to push out this way. And of course, now with a lot of trends from a social catering, is that people tend to go to, cool events and houses and mansions and parks barns and that is a trend not just here nationally. I've seen it all over the country. So that is certainly one of our other concerns as well. So
if we could just back up with the Renaissance being under renovation, if you're not aware, the Renaissance does fall under the Marriott flag, and Marriott guests are very, very loyal to the Marriott brand. So that's why they chose to come down to Franklin versus a different hotel in the Nashville area.
And then kind of sum it up, Randy, with some highlights and expenses.
Yeah, just explaining some of the ups and downs a little bit. We're actually saving about $21,000 in the IT department. The Marriott fees for their sales system actually went down a couple of months ago, so that's big news when Marriott lowers their fees. A&G, we're saving about $34,000. I won't say the position was open because Andy was filling in as the acting general manager, pulling double duty, and actually did an awesome job. But the position we anticipate, Michael, will be full all year. And then just pointing out, it was interesting to hear the transit presentation because I think everyone realizes the labor situation here. I mean, if you're not working, you don't want to work. But so we're always looking for people, and we use a lot of contract labor. And as new hotels come on board, obviously we're competing with them. So wages have gone up pretty significantly over the last couple of years, and with the Hilton, we can throw a rock over and hit their building. That's another
220
rooms, or
Michael Sanders.
Michael Sanders. Yeah. And then the only other thing is we really had a pretty extraordinary year last year, and so we anticipate not paying out the amount of management bonuses this year that we did last year. That can change, but if it changes, if those management bonuses go up, it's because revenue and expenses, revenue and profit has gone up. So
I would make one other note. When you see those net profit numbers, before you get to that net profit, we're also reserving dollars aside for facility improvements, maintenance, repair, upkeep items that come our way.
5%.
5%, some of which we can anticipate, and we have some things on the schedule, and other things they happen as part of the nature of an operation like that. So that is a true net profit number, and we continue to set aside. And that worked very effectively. The renovation that happened and completed in 15 was fully funded by the dollars that have been reserved over time by city and county for that very purpose. So just so everybody understands, we are putting dollars aside to keep the facility up to a standard that is competitive in the market. And that's part of, I think, a wise structure that's been put in place here. So.
And
Are we still 50-50 with the county?
We are.
Do we have any debt on the property?
Our debt was paid off probably 4 years ago. Yeah, so. Yeah, we've been off for a little while, and county just paid theirs off, so we're that's a good thing.
We have an approximate like fair market value of the conference center.
It really depends on how you look at it, you know, as an operation versus just it's obviously very valuable land as well, mm-hmm. in terms of it's a prime location. So there's a lot of different ways to kind of slice that, but obviously the conference center has a benefit to the community in terms of supporting local business, community events, all those kind of things that right. are kind of hard to quantify from a market standpoint, but it's a very valuable asset.
And I would just point out that the facility is almost 20 years old, and certainly the Davidson is the ones who help keep up and do the facilities maintenance on the conference center, which is a city county owned facility. And these are the gentlemen that I work with directly, and then certainly with our staff that as this building, you know, certain pieces of the mechanical structure have reached the, you know, the end of their life cycle as you get 18, 20 years old. And we do have a good working relationship. As Eric was talking about, there's certain aspects to facilities management that you have on a schedule of how long it will last. We had a dishwasher there was a projection for when it would, you know, was original to the facility that in the last year had to be replaced. And we worked, you know, consulted together as well as parts of the sprinkler system. The mechanics of a sprinkler system as it gets 20 years old have been replaced in the last several months. So certainly this is the face of the folks that we as staff interact with to make sure that the county's and the city's investment in the facility is maintained properly. And we as staff appreciate that type of the excellent communication that we receive from these gentlemen, because certainly it makes that they're the eyes on the ground. So
within that 20 years, all but 2 years, it's returned a positive return back to the city and county, which is pretty remarkable.
Yes.
For a facility like this. Most places, communities have them, and you know, you just have to put some into it to just keep it functioning because of the community benefit and the need it fills. We've been fortunate enough that it's been successful to the level that the city and county are getting a return of some level, depending on the mm-hmm. how we've done in a given year, all but 2 years in that 20-year run, which is a compliment to the team mm-hmm. and what's happening in the community.
And as well as these natural life cycle replacements are being covered in the replacement in the reserve fund. So we coordinate to make sure that we approve that it's time to replace the dishwasher, but those monies are coming from the reserve fund that's been set aside. So
and our director of engineering, Mark Perriman, will milk every bit of life out of
yes,
any piece
does.
Of equipment as long as he can before it has to be replaced. So he does a great job.
Good stuff. Any other questions? Gentlemen, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Appreciate it.
You're welcome.
Let's go to item six, consideration of resolution 2018-2018, the resolution to revise the organizational chart within the law department. All right.
Come on, Alan, we can get a chair here.
We can get a chair up for you. Can I grab a chair?
All right, so this resolution, the only thing it does, if you look on page 2, you can see the exhibit of our existing resolution or existing org chart and then the proposed org chart. Under the first existing organizational chart, you'll see paralegal is under assistant city attorney. And all we're asking to do is move all the positions just directly under me. There's no financial impact to this at all. It's just, as you know, because the org charts are attached as part of the budget, they do have to go through and be changed, you know, through proper procedure. Right.
Yeah. So that's it?
That's all
that's
for
it?
That item, yes. Now to the hard stuff.
All right. There is a little bit of announcement about, we're going to fill our vacancy. Do you want to mention just a quick comment?
I guess I did want to make sure that before we get through that, if the committee does have a recommendation on item six before Shauna will be given a presentation about her budget, but we will need action on six. Thank you.
But I can announce, if you would like, that our assistant city attorney position has been officially filled with our candidate, Misty Foy. She is an attorney in the city of Chattanooga's office of their law department. And she lives in Murfreesboro, and she commutes every day from Murfreesboro to Chattanooga. So we're really excited to have her come on. She's going to start April 30th.
She needed Todd.
She needed Todd.
There's some folks in the city attorney's office in Chattanooga that are not real happy with Shauna right now.
That's true. That's true.
We need a motion on the organizational chart change.
Move for approval.
Second.
All in favor indicate by saying, any other questions on that? All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Recommended to go to the.
Put it on consent.
Put it on consent.
Yeah, that's pretty straightforward.
Okay. All right. And now the budget presentation.
Following right along. So let me pull up the PowerPoint so I can follow along with you guys. It's up there. Okay, good. So the outline, of course, is the purpose of our department, our org chart, which now you've just changed, and so it will also be reflected in the new budget, base budget request, and our summary. So going to the next page. As you know, the purpose of our law department is to provide legal services to the mayor, to you, to the city administrator, to the department directors, boards, commissions, committees, and other city officials. And so that's what we do. Going to the next page is the organizational chart as you just recommended that it be changed. And so assuming that that goes through, that's what it will look like. And then on the next page, you'll see the positions and the pay grades. There's nothing different with that. And then the next page is the base budget request. As you can see in our budget, we have no enhancement requests. It's pretty much the same budget, with increases that are required to continue doing our work at the law department. We did have to add a little bit more income in the, well, I guess money into the registration for CLEs and travel expenses because, excitingly enough, this past year, Tiffany Pope, who was our paralegal, passed the bar, went to law school, passed the bar, and now she's a lawyer. So in order for us to keep her license up, we do need to send her to the CLE classes like we go to. And just so I can introduce our team, Tiffany Pope, now staff attorney, Melda, she is our paralegal, and Ellen, and she is the legal assistant. I think you guys know all of them, but just faces to names. And that's really our budget. I would love to answer any questions that you may have.
Let me highlight one thing that we'll do within existing resources that we're going to take a hard look at this coming year. And we've worked with this before, but we find more and more a need to have some assistance with legislative matters up at the State House. We had a lobbyist that we kind of shared with Brentwood at one point. Then we went to sort of where we just used sort of on-demand kind of consulting services with another entity. We'll be taking another look at that. We think there's adequate resources in the budget and law department in terms of outside services to cover what we may need, but there's just a lot going on. Shauna and Ellen do a great job of tracking what's happening, but we have a lot of other responsibilities that they are involved in too, and having folks that can help us track and also make sure we get in front of the right people at the right time to make sure the city's interests are heard effectively is a service I think we need to take another look at. So we're gonna look at a way to allocate within the existing budget how to get some of those services more formally in place for us.
That's right. Ellen, every week, looks at the calendar for the House and the Senate and all of their committees and all of their subcommittees, and we have a list of bills that we're following that we're interested in. But as you know, sometimes a bill might look innocuous and then amendments happen, and you really kind of have to have boots on the ground to see how these amendments are being filed, because when you look at them online, you won't know about that amendment really unless someone's told you about it. It takes a lot of time. I think Ellen probably spends hours a week working on you know, compiling email and documents about what bills are going to be before a committee or a subcommittee this next week. And we do communicate with our legislators, but we found, I think, we might need more than just our four to help us work through some of the issues that we have facing our cities. Any other questions about the law department budget? Happy to answer them. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Keep us safe.
That is true.
Keep out the headlines.
Item 8, 2019 budget presentation for human resources. Another attorney sitting there. Yeah. Wow.
Yeah, you can't miss him.
I tell you what. How did we do that?
Well, good afternoon. I'm going to go over the human resources budget request. And just like Shauna said, we're just going to go through the purpose of the department, organizational chart, the base budget request, both personnel and operations, program enhancements, and then I'll summarize at the very end. Well, the purpose of the department is to obviously recruit, hire, retain, onboard our employees, administer the city's defined benefit, defined contribution plan, and TCRS, create and implement personnel rules and regulations, manage the training of all city employees on OSHA, civil treatment, and other areas as required and needed, procuring and administering all property and casualty insurance, managing the safety program for all city employees, managing employee benefits, and conducting workplace investigations. So the next one is the org chart. And what you see is 12 positions, all of which are filled currently, except for the HR manager position, which we're posting. We've got internal applicants and external applicants for that position, which we'll be filling shortly. As far as the base budget request, it's a 1.1% increase, which you would think, if I'm not adding any personnel, where does that come from? It just so happens that more people now are using the our benefits portion, so that's what you see a little bit of an increase for. But we will maintain the current number of our full-time employees next year. As far as the base budget request and operations, that represents a decrease of about $27,000. The decrease is largely attributed to the remaining payment for TrackStar, which is our electronic employee evaluation system. And we've had some program enhancement requests. And to explain what those are, the first deal with we're going to restructure, well, not restructure, but fill some of the vacancies. The person who's been doing risk management and benefits and HR is going to move up a sum, which will have some openings for a risk manager and a benefits manager. So that's part of the first couple of program enhancements. After that is civil treatment. And what that is that's the process we use to keep all of our employees up to speed on sexual harassment, discrimination, how to treat people appropriately. To do so, we use a very well-used program, ELI, based out of Atlanta. And it's not an inexpensive program, but it's priced right. It requires us having some of our people train in Atlanta we can't have the program. We don't have people trained to train our employees on the program. And then we have to purchase books for it. So that's what that program enhancement is for. The next one is to track certificates of insurance. And that's a program which will enable people to put, it's a cloud-based system, and it allows us to put certificates of insurance in the cloud, to pull them from the cloud, to adhere to all sorts of contract requests. Something which is not manageable as simply as it used to be days ago. Now it's pretty much everyone's going to a cloud-based system. That's what we're looking for. And then the final two deal with the renovation of the HR department's physical structure. It's obviously we pride ourselves in being one of the important faces of the government of the city of Franklin, and our spaces, we have some original carpeting from when it was a mall, so we would like to upgrade some of that, and then also
it's probably historic now.
It is probably historic, you're correct. And so is some of the furniture, too, so we don't think.
I don't doubt it.
No expected doors or anything.
That's right, that's right. So that really does express what we're looking for, what we were requesting this year. And I said I'd sum up, so let's sum up by showing off a little bit. Last year, we reduced the number of days in the recruitment process by 30%. We also, the city received over $600,000 in pharmacy rebates. That's over the last 12 months. The city's mod rating, that's the workers' comp rating. You know, if you're hitting the mark, if you're having the same amount of injuries that other people have in your field, you have a mod rating of 1. We have a mod rating, and we've had a mod rating of less than 1, and it still is less than 1. It's 0.74. It's phenomenal. We have an increased wellness program, which offers flu shots, the annual health and wellness fair, group fitness, yoga classes, walking challenges, risk assessment, health challenges. That wellness program has provided a lot of benefit to the city. We've also implemented a Chrono self-service timesheet program, which helps increase accuracy and efficiency. We've completed our second annual evaluation process. It used to be paper-based, now it's electronic-based. You get a lot of comments, it stores easily. A lot of different people can look over it, can change it. We successfully completed our second evaluation cycle. And then also we've had Access Perks now for a year, which is simply Access Perks is around the country. We're now a part of that. It enables our employees to have a lot of services at discounted costs. So that is my presentation. Any questions?
Are we still tracking for the high deductible plan option in July?
We're still looking into it.
The
high deductible. Yeah. I thought you were on something else.
Oh, yeah.
High deductible, yes, sir, okay. In July.
Yeah. So we'll be rolling that out to our employees and helping them understand what that can mean for them and have a structure we think will be very helpful in giving a truly different option for our employees. Because right now our two, option one and option two, are pretty similar mm-hmm. to one another. This will really be differentiated and give people a chance to put some dollars in their pocket but manage their health a little differently going forward. So.
Correct.
Any other questions? Kevin, thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Item 9, budget presentation, communications. Oh, yes.
Hello.
How do you do?
All right. We now have the PowerPoint up for the communications budget presentation. And as everyone else did, we'll go through the outline. We'll show the purpose of our department, the organizational chart, the base budget request, the program enhancements, and the summary. So the purpose of our department or division, and we were created in December 2008 to develop internal and external communications and citizen participation in initiatives. The division also handles all media relations for the city and manages the city's government access channel and Franklin TV and all social media. And here's a look at our org chart. We have a social and digital media producer, which is Stephen Price. We have a cable TV production operations supervisor, that's Stefan Duran. And we have a public outreach specialist, that's Monique McCullough. And we have a wonderful part-timer, Robert Mott, and they're all taping this right now, so, except for Monique and me. And then the base budget request is right there. You can see that. And a little bit of increase in the base budget over fiscal year 2018. And then the base budget request operations. I'm not sure. I think Michael can explain this one.
So good afternoon, everyone. It's important as we get into these smaller budgets, and especially what we label the administrative budgets or the support service budgets, you're going to see some rather large percentage differences when it comes to operations. That's for two reasons. Well, three. Number one is the fact that they're just much smaller dollar amounts than you've seen in some of the larger departments. So a little increase or little decrease obviously can result in a much larger percentage change. Number two, There's 8 or 9 departments within the city that have what we call interfund reimbursements. We give them a credit, and we budget it all in expenses because it's easier to budget in one place, so we stick it in operations. We give them a credit for services that they provide to our business type activity funds. This is a standard form of governmental accounting where the water, sewer, stormwater, and sanitation funds, fee-based service funds, get charged an amount from or by the general fund departments for services that they render. A part of Eric's time, a part of Christine's time, a part of my time is spent in general administration, budget management. Part of Melissa and Monique's time is spent in communication of, you know, how they can access. So if you, city services, think about the ad campaigns right now on sanitation trucks and, you know, previous, the Grease Busters campaign. That's the communications department working for the water and wastewater division. Department. It's very standard. There's a calculation. We can certainly provide that calculation to you. But if you see negative numbers, in this case, they provide more than the rest of their expenses combined in reimbursement and service to those other departments. That's why their operations is a negative number.
And it lands in operations, even though it may be related to personnel,
right,
as well. So you have to put it someplace, and that's where it lands.
It's just easier than adding another layer of accounting to try to determine, well, this much is for people and this much is for expenses, and so therefore the negative is there. The important point is that on the bottom line, it all comes together. The third reason why you're seeing wild swings or larger than normal swings, well, that's a wild would be a bad term when it comes to finance, larger than perhaps normal swings is because we are ramping down our lease payments that are budgeted within departmental budgets in fiscal 19. So if there were departments such as HR that we used lease monies to buy the TrackStar evaluation system, that's another large reduction of money. That will not be a factor come 2020 because beginning next year's budget, the city will not be engaged in leasing.
All right, that was a very good explanation. We like to think of ourselves as PR agency for all the departments, and he explained that very well. We are just requesting $5,600, which is an increase for our PR and marketing for many of the things that we promote within the city. And what I sent around with you today, and I didn't really do a PowerPoint on this, but this is the tree lighting. We've grown this over the years. And this is the return on investment. And our news and media audience, we reached, and we didn't spend nearly as much as this, we reached 785,000 people more than. And the TV publicity value was about 10,744. We did not spend anything on TV advertising. And the online news publicity value was valued at over $23,000. So the total free media we got for that was over $34,000. We reached, we went live. So thank you very much for letting us get that HD equipment because we are able to stream live on Facebook, YouTube, and then also on our website. We can go live with programming now. And so thank you for letting us have that equipment last year. We were able to reach a lot of people across the country with our tree lighting event and many other events. We were able to go live with the Veterans Day Parade as well. But just the calendar event reached over 300,000 people. You can see all of the dates that we posted here. Our post reached over 100,000 people. The video views that we did, over 32,000 people. Twitter impressions, over 6,000, close to 7,000. Instagram likes, 684. Website views, 35,000. The tree lighting page was one of our most viewed pages when we just recently did some research as we're redesigning our web page. So people really like that event. It's grown, and what we're doing with streaming video is really, I think, working with our public and their relatives beyond Franklin and visitors as well. So thank you so much for that last year.
Melissa, go ahead.
I was just going to say, we had the tree lighting on Friday, I think, instead of, did that Was that one of the big reasons, too? Because I could not believe how many people came.
I think so. A lot of people would come on Thursday, but we would hear in the crowd, when is it going to start? When is it going to start? Because we have to get our little kids home to go to bed.
Good point.
And okay. So everyone loved the Friday night, and we're doing that again this year, and we were able to double our sponsorship money this year with our same sponsors, Middle Tennessee Electric, Mars Pet Care, and Williamson Medical Center. So
I was just going to mention that the information Melissa ran through for you real quick was what we used to talk to the sponsors, and we started with the folks that sponsored this year, and they were anxious to get on board. In fact, they're competing with each other a little bit about what level of sponsorship they could do, because they were so impressed with the reach and felt so good about the event. And as you pointed out, the crowd was larger, and they stayed through the evening because they didn't have to get home to get kids to bed for school and all that. And that was just made for a really nice community experience for everybody.
Yeah, I would have thought Friday night they may have had other things to do, but obviously not. It really turned out well, didn't it?
High school football's over, so they could just hang out.
Yeah.
And we're also partnering with the Downtown Franklin Association now, and so they had a lot of things going on in their stores. That last year event was on Art Crawl Night. This year won't be Art Crawl Night, but I know a lot of the merchants will be participating and getting involved and having special things in their stores for that night as well.
That's good, because the only thing I heard against it was that a lot of people said it took forever to get to be able to eat, because there were so many people there.
It took forever to get out of the park.
Well, now that's true, too. Good point. Yeah. Good point.
Good problems to have.
That's true. It did take a long time to get out, didn't it? Yes.
That's about it.
Great.
Does anyone have any questions?
What was the ROI on that chair dance off?
What's that?
What was the ROI on that chair dance off?
Fortunately, it was a pretty low budget production, although they did a beautiful job. The actors and dancers were free. In fact, we should have probably paid people to watch it.
Yeah, I think it was the choreographer.
The choreography was actually okay. The execution, not so good.
I'm still getting comments on my dank steps a few years ago.
Yeah, from the happy video?
Yes,
Clyde. Everybody, all the aldermen danced in that video.
Yeah.
We need to get that back online.
Thank you.
All right, thank you.
Good job, guys.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Budget presentation for elected officials and administration. So you doing that?
I'll go ahead and cover that if you'd like, but you all can chime in too if you have any budget requests. This is your time. We'll pull up the presentation. Of course, we'll run through the different elements of this. We'll talk first about the elected officials, the Board of Mayor and Aldermen, and then the city administration component. Of course, your purpose is to represent our citizens and to help and to establish policy and procedure guidelines, adopt resolutions, ordinances, and the municipal code, and you chart the course for the city. And so that's reflected in your purpose. You'll see the org chart where, of course, you work for the citizens of Franklin, and they get to decide who they're hiring every couple years, and that's good. And the mayor and aldermen, of course, are split between at-large aldermen and ward aldermen, and this org chart reflects how we're set up there. When you look at the base budget, you'll see a decrease overall. The primary decrease in operations is we do not have an election in this next fiscal year, and of course that's usually incorporated in that, but in your budget and in the elected officials budget, and so that's around $50,000 these days for that municipal election. So that's not needed to carry through here. You will see a little decrease in the personnel. We're not having you take a pay cut. It's just a different composition of benefits among the board than was there a year ago. So that's what that reflects. And that really covers the elected official numbers. We don't have any program enhancements that we're proposing right there at this point. We'll move on to administration. Of course, that is the office that includes the city administrator and our administrative staff. And we are responsible for the day-to-day operations of the city, following the direction of the board, connecting the board to your strategic direction and the work of the professional staff. And pleased to do that. And you'll see the org chart that we have here, which again reflects my role as city administrator. We have assistant city recorder for records, that's Linnea right behind me, and she oversees the administrative staff, and then the three assistant city administrators, which we now have on board. We made a little organizational adjustment over about a year or so ago, and have assistant city administrator for community and economic development, that's Vernon Girth. Assistant City Administrator for Public Works, that's Mark Hilty, and Assistant City Administrator and Chief Financial Officer, Christine Talent, is right here with you today. So along with those, of course, I also have reporting to me a number of other positions in the organization, including Police Chief, Fire Chief, HR Director, City Attorney as well. So that reflects the administration org chart within our existing budget there. We have, again, fairly stable budget overall, just a 1% increase compared to the current year budget. And Michael gave you an explanation of how the ins and outs work related to the recapture. That's why our operational numbers are fairly low. We do have one program enhancement to help keep our documents that we're required to keep safe. We would have requested a fireproof lateral filing cabinet, which is $10,000. So that'll help Linda keep things from out of harm's way. Yeah. So that's what that reflects as well.
How big is that? Where will you put that?
Linda already has some in her office. They, right? Don't you along the?
I have one.
One. Okay.
One fireproof.
Yeah. So it's. It doesn't look much different than our
regular
filing cabinet, really.
We'll be replacing the two laterals with the two fireproof.
Okay. Yeah. But size-wise, they're not really noticeably different, are they?
No, the lateral one's bigger than the fireproof.
It is actually smaller than what you have?
The fireproof one I have is small.
Okay.
The smallest one.
So there you go. And this, just to conclude, you know, our job in administration is to support the elected officials and the city organization and day-to-day operations, what we do in terms of strategic management and leadership. And we like to talk about these five key principles, something I talked to you about in an interview almost 10 years ago, about being focused on excellence, innovation, teamwork, integrity, and being action-oriented. So that's our presentation. Be glad to take any questions.
Questions? You sure we don't want to? You sure you don't have some
good
questions?
Good job, yeah.
Item 11, budget presentation for revenue management and city court.
All right. Hello.
It is a pleasure to be with you today. I'm Lawrence Sullivan, and I'm the manager of the Revenue Management Department and the clerk of the court. We work for Christine Talent, our new CFO, Assistant City Administrator. We're very excited to work with Christine.
I'm not so new anymore, though. Yeah, it's her second budget. So.
Well, it's her second budget. But we're still so excited. So.
Wow.
He's not tired of me yet. That's pretty good, though.
I have with me today Deanne Kraft, who works in the revenue management area, helps out with court and things as well. But she's our accounting officer in this area. So she is getting more and more involved in the budget, and there may be a day soon where she just comes up here and brings this to you. So that'll be exciting. Our outline was very short. You're going to see two budgets today. One's revenue management, the other's court. And the purpose of the department, we'll start with revenue management. The team performs all the billing, collections, customer service for the city of Franklin, water, wastewater, stormwater, sanitation services, the collection of the business taxes, alcohol taxes, shared revenues taxes, hotel motel taxes, and then numerous permits. It's all done with a group of people back there in the revenue management office just behind us. The organizational chart is that there are two areas that have some employees that are customer service frontline people helping us there, and a section that is the, we call it the wet and the dry, but they're the dry side, handling the money and making deposits, things, getting the bills and doing those things. And Deanne is the accounting officer in this organizational chart. Our base budget request is to stay stable as we are with the 14 full-time positions and three part-time positions that would equal two full-time equivalents potentially at the most. We are operating with some part-time folks in both revenue management and in the court, and it gives us a great deal of flexibility and cross-utilization opportunities. So that's been good for us. and we'll seek to continue to find opportunities to increase our productivity throughout the year. Our operational costs, we're one of those departments that gets an allocation, and Michael's got our operational costs down $3,000 for next year. But not many of the costs have changed. We're pretty conservative, pretty stable operation. There is one program enhancement request, and sitting just behind us is our IT director, because they were afraid I would start telling you how to order a pizza or something. So, but we are absolutely going to reach the new world of how people transact business, like ordering a pizza online. We will have our customers with an electronic bill presentment and payment option this year. They will set up an online account with the city, be able to access their records with the utilities. They'll choose how to receive their bill and how to pay their bill. It could be by text, it could be by email, it could be by the U.S. Post Office still, or any mix of the above. In 2019, we project that there will be fulfillment costs of $250,000, 345,000 pieces of mail if we didn't implement this. And if you look at that number, and we could convert potentially 30% of those to not getting a piece of paper, it's about 100,000 letters that we won't mail. Some pretty significant opportunity to save money there. Yes, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you. If we can,
some of this has been made possible by the transition we've made in our system. You all may recall over the last few years we've been working on a transition to an updated utility billing system, and we really needed to have that in place before we could implement something like this. So that's one of the fruits of that labor, and Lawrence and the team and IT and finance have worked diligently to get that system up and going, and we're fully converted to that system now. So this is part of why we wanted to do that. It gives us much more flexibility, the ability to do this kind of thing, and do better real-time tracking of what our customers are experiencing.
Yes, sir. And it really, there are many options the way this is presented. There are many vendors. We are beginning to interview people to find out what our choices are, what our options are, whether we have somebody that handles a significant portion of this or whether we split it into pieces. We keep some and pass some parts out, but we'll do whatever's the most fiscally sound and responsible. But we do project, if you, the math kind of added up to $40,000 again in savings. If we have about postage savings of 40 cents a piece, there's some little bit of printing cost savings, but there's still some service to process the bills, even when they're electronic. But if we do 100,000 pieces, or 30% of our mail, we'll save about $40,000. So it really would be a zero cost to the bottom line. And each of you can take credit with your own constituents. There'll be about 8,000 people in that number that'll be happy that they're paying online if you do that. So you can tell them it was your doing to do that. That's our enhancement. We expect that to be something that can be online as hopefully as soon as the end of this calendar year. So
my question is, when
will we see this? Yes, ma'am. And then the city court, our mission is to effectively and accurately process city ordinance violations, allowing the court to handle cases in the most efficient manner possible, to create and sustain customer service-oriented quality service, and to promote public confidence in our court system. The organizational chart was missing Judge Hood, so I have scribbled her name at the top of my chart. She's in her fourth year serving as judge.
Not and good. It
is, sir?
Not good.
Not good. Not good. But I really worked hard thanking Christine for being here, didn't I?
I'm sure Judge Hood is there for the
final. she is on the front. She's very pleasant with whom to work. She's doing a great job, and court is, we get great responses both about Judge Hood, and you may hear them in the community as well, but also the staff that's here diligently working. It's a small team, two full-time people, and then we have two part-time staff members allocated, but we are currently planning to only fill one of those positions. For that front office to be open the way we want it to be open and need it to be open during normal business hours for the city, it really takes two full-time people to help cover for time off, things like that. And a part-time person gives us the flexibility to expand on court days to give the best service when we're having court going on, and or to cover when other things are out. So with the flexibility of part-time is, again, an important aspect for us. And this budget reflects us converting back. We did have three full-time people last year. This budget reflects us converting back to two part-time people. The way we count that in the budget looks like we'll spend more money in the budget itself but we're not going to spend that money. It's really one full-time equivalent, and we're not even going to get that far. So it does show an increase of $12,000 in the personnel budget, but we won't, we'll undershoot that this year. And there's a decrease in our operations, as Michael alluded earlier, that we have finished a lease payment for the electronic ticketing. So there's a $32,000 decline, or 27% in operating costs for not having the electronic ticketing lease expense again. And I've spoken about Judge Hood and the surroundings, the third year up front, and everyone's accustomed to that and comfortable with it, and it's a great office and a great group of folks there. So our most exciting news is the electronic ticketing, and everything else is pretty standard. Are there any questions? Because Deanne is here to answer them.
Well, do we not have some questions? Do we not have?
Go ahead. Huh?
Kind of want to come up with one.
Next time I'll come back. Next year I'll come back and sit with her and let y'all ask me the questions. Okay. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Item 12, budget presentation for information technology.
Good afternoon. Thank you. Most of you know me, but I'm Jordan Shaw. I'm your IT director. This is the first time presenting the budget as the IT director. I've actually sat as the assistant director in previous years, but now I have my new assistant director with me, Jason Potts, who also has sat up here in front of you all before. So we'll do the standard outline as the other departments have followed, the purpose of our department, our organizational chart, base budget, program enhancements, and finally a summary. All right, purpose of our department. Our goal or our mission here is to provide innovative, reliable technology solutions to the departments within the city of Franklin so that they can exchange, provide those types of services to our citizens. So we are charged to, as being an internal service department, we also are excited to work with Christine on the finance and administration team. Not really sure how finance falls into IT, but I think it's because they want to watch our costs. But
it works out well.
It works out really well. All right, organizational chart. You might remember back in September, I brought a change in our organizational chart. Once I got into this role in July and started looking at and evaluating how we are functioning, this new organizational chart made sense. I'm happy to report that the organizational chart is still working as we saw that it would. We have two defined groups. We have an application group, which is led up by assistant director, and then we have an infrastructure group, also led up by assistant director. And that assistant director is Jason, who also helps me on the administration of the department, which is why you see him here helping with the budget. Base budget, for the most part, is staying the same. We actually have a slight decrease of 0.7%. That is largely due to an increase with some of our software maintenance services, but a decrease in the GIS fly that we did this previous year that we won't do in the upcoming year. And we'll talk a little bit more about that when we get into the program enhancements. Same on personnel. We have 22 full-time staff and 2 part-time staff. Program enhancements, we do have 16 this year. So we'll go through these. We'll take any questions as you have them come up. Jason and I will kind of tag team on the different ones that we've worked on separately. So I'll let him start on the first one, and then we'll go from there.
Good afternoon. So the enhancement number one will be a communications technician that we're asking for. So the role of this new position would be to work directly with our fiber, our radio, and our wireless technologies. We currently have two individuals that's dedicated to this team, so this will allow a third person to help with the implementation of the fiber and support on radio and the wireless that we have in-house.
I would like to add here, this is a part-time upgrade. So we do have a current part-time position on staff. It's extremely difficult to fill a part-time position in IT. We were fortunate that we had a retiree in this position until he received a full-time role at the county and left us. So that is the purpose of the upgrade.
Thank you. Enhancement number two is the network technician two. We currently have two network technician ones that is in our organizational chart. This right here would be more of a mid-level type of position that would really help out with the ordering, the computer replacement cycle, and the number of requests that we're beginning to receive. So this would be something that would greatly benefit the staff and the tickets that we get. Do you want to add anything to that, Jordan?
No, the big thing that this person would manage would be our computer lifecycle replacement. We replace about 300 or so computers a year. It's really important that we keep those computers in warranty with the manufacturers so that, and our warranty is every 3 years. So every 3 years, we're basically replacing a third of the computers within the city, and that would be a large responsibility of this role.
Working with the individual departments to make sure that monies and who's getting what is, we're staying on top of that properly. So, enhancement number three is a wireless controller. So this will add to our wireless, in-building wireless that we have in the city hall and over at the police department. And it currently functions at all city locations, but the two controllers are housed at City Hall and over at PD. So this enhancement would be to replace those. And this is driven by a life cycle of the technology that we have in place. It's been in place currently for about 7 to 8 years. So it's a life cycle upgrade, per se.
So $60,000 for two?
Yes, ma'am.
Two replacements.
All right, number four, drone project. So I say we'd get back to the GIS fly. We actually completed the GIS fly last year, actually did it in February of this calendar year. That fly cost us right at $120,000. Now it's extremely important to do these flies because it gets us updated imagery. That one also had LIDAR part of it so that we can see elevations. There's a lot of good data that comes from those flies, but fiscally, $120,000 every year is not realistic. We're issuing over, as you all know, over 1,000 building permits a year. So from the time they complete the fly in February to 3 months later when we actually get the data from that, there's already been almost 300 permits issued. So by the time we get the data, it's somewhat out of date. What the drone would allow us to do is actually go out any new plan development that we have, we could fly that ourselves and get an updated imagery of that so that we can keep that data as up to date as possible. Now that doesn't account for unexpected changes that we don't know about. So we'd still want to stay on kind of the 3-year plan we've been for the larger GIS flies. But this would allow us to get that intermediate updated data in between those flies. It's $20,000, it's $15,000 for the drone itself. It's a survey quality drone. It's a little bit different than what you see, maybe at Best Buy that goes out and flies for video. There's GPS that goes into it. A lot of accuracy, we're talking about within inches of accuracy versus a few feet. So that's the reason for the cost of it. The $5,000 is the software that pulls that data in and puts it into our Esri system to be able to serve it out on maps. And I'm happy to report that one of our GIS staff members was recently certified with the FAA, certification 107, which gives him the rights to go out and fly drones. Have a pilot on staff. Item number five is the GIS fiber software. So we currently track our fiber throughout the city in our Esri system. Now I can tell you on any street where the fiber is located, if it's underground, above ground, but what I can't tell you is how much slack's in that fiber, how many strands of fiber are actually in the pool that goes to the ground. The detailed information about that fiber itself. This software would allow us to track that. More importantly than that, is because we can track the slack and the footage and everything about that fiber, if we run a tracking on that to see where, say, a break's at, it will tell us exactly where it's at on that strand of fiber as opposed to just guessing, which is what we'd have to do at this point. So that's what this $30,000 is for. It's a detailed Esri GIS software that allow us to track our fiber more efficiently. Number six, citywide scanning project. We have many departments that have documents that have a document retention on them. They're setting many cases in rooms, closets, taking up real estate in the city hall, over at the courthouse, different places throughout the city. What this project is to work with departments in the city to actually get those scanned into our on-base electronic document management system. We work with Linnea and her team, and then there's a company in Nashville we'd work in to actually bring them in to scan this. Now, with the documents that I have seen, I can tell you that $50,000 will not cover it all, but $50,000 is the amount that we would be able to accomplish in a year's time and give us a better evaluation next year of where we're at that point. Scanning this in would actually also allow us to, you know, regain some of that real estate that's currently being used for just document storage. All right, number seven.
So number seven is the video security system that we have in place. We have this at multiple facilities. We have quite a few at PD and at City Hall. This this system has proved to be very beneficial over the last year to year and a half since we've got it in place, providing security for staff and other means. We have a lot of cameras in both parking garages. So we're getting to the point now that the system that we currently have in place, we need to add to that. So this is what enhancement number seven would do, is add capacity and processing power so we could continue to grow that video security camera infrastructure. Moving on to item number eight. This is it's the Cisco ACS VPN appliance. So what this does is allows staff to work remotely and provide connectivity, secure connectivity when they're not here at the office. So this has proved to be a very very important tool, especially in today's the way that we work and accomplish things. So that's what item number eight for the hardware appliance is.
All right, moving right along, halfway there. Item number nine, Rhythm for Civics. Well, that is a unique name, actually has a very, very useful purpose for us. We currently use a software today called Dynamic Portal, which is what we use if a citizen had to file a complaint or something about a pothole, or they saw graffiti, or just wanted some type of request from the city, we would use our Dynamic Portal to allow them to submit that customer service request. That would then get routed to the proper department to address it. In addition, we also use Dynamic Portal for builders to schedule inspections. Mm-hmm. So they can schedule those through our BNS staff, and they use Dynamic Portal to do that. The problem with Dynamic Portal is we don't have any type of customization. So what we get today is what we'll always have with Dynamic Portal. There's no modifications we can make to it. The company that provides that is Enforce, the same company we use for all of our building permits, including also utility billing. It's really our enterprise system we do for most of our departments. They have now developed this Rhythm for Civics, which is a replacement for Dynamic Portal. The Rhythm for Civics gives us a lot of capabilities to customize the application. We can request additional information that we've never been able to request before, information that might be vital to understanding where the actual issue might be, information that might be vital to the actual inspection that's happening, and so forth. In addition, it has a GIS integration. So if you notice a pothole, you can go to the Rhythm for Civics portal and see if that pothole has already been reported. You don't have to report it again. So there's a lot of integration there. It would allow us to get rid of Rhythm, or for Dynamic Portal, which is currently $27,000 a year. The new software is $31,000 a year. So it's $4,000 for the software. This program enhancement is an additional $36,000 to work with the software vendor just to have consulting when we put it in place. This is up to $36,000. We might not necessarily need that all. We might not need any of it. It's just to have that assurance that if we get into a bind while setting up the software, we have somewhere to call to get help to have that set up. So that $36,000 is for consulting.
Next item is the network technician one role. So this individual, their primary job would be to work tickets as they come into the ticket system, and they would be frontline support for the network team for issues that any of the staff and the other departments were running into. They would have a major contributor to a lot of the computer replacements. They would be helping the physical part of going out and replacing the computers as well. So that's what this role would perform for us.
All right. Item 11 is video security cameras for our data center and IT data closets. Each one of the facilities throughout the city has some type of data closet. And then at the police department and Fire Station 6, we also have a data center. The access to these facilities are extremely important that we monitor and have security in place. This would allow us to add an additional level of security and put a video camera so we can actually visually see who comes and goes out of those areas. It's 10 doors that we'd monitor at a cost of $2,000 a door for the cameras.
The ExaGrid backup appliance, with all the malware and security threats that come on in today's world, this backups are very, very important that we have the ability to be able to provide and restore when something does happen. So we currently have our backup site, our backup system that runs in our data center. So this item right here would actually run out at Station 6. So it would basically be a backup to our backup. So that's what this system would provide. It would provide us the ability to go in if there's anything that from a security aspect that gets messed up in the original backup file, we could go in and restore this. It's another level of insurance for all the data that we have in place for the city.
Go ahead.
Hacking. Where's the hacking protection?
Hacking protection.
That's
it's. So we actually have a lot of that in place today.
Okay.
We've gotten that in previous years, and we're continuously improving it. You'll actually see number 16 as a security audit to see how we're doing with that.
Okay. Just keep going, then. I don't want.
All right. So item number 13. Solar Winds additional license. We currently use Solar Winds as an application to monitor our network and our application servers. It gives us information. For example, if you're getting the cold, you'd start seeing symptoms of that cold prior to actually getting it. This software allows us to see those symptoms before the application actually has an issue. It allows us to be very proactive in remediating those potential issues. The SolarWinds additional license would allow us to put more granular monitoring on our database servers. Our database is what stores all of the data for the various applications, so it just allows us to monitor that and be more proactive as potential issues could arise.
Backup internet circuit. So as a lot of the tools that we use today are provided in the cloud, our email for one, our Kronos time system. The internet is extremely crucial, especially for business continuity of other departments that they use. So in the event that we had an issue with our internet service provider, we would have a secondary internet circuit, and that's what this cost would be for. So.
And I will add that is extremely rare. However, it just happened yesterday afternoon. We went down, it was a very short period of time. We got it back up as quickly as possible, but it is something that happens. We're dependent on a vendor to provide us a service, and that would be the purpose of the backup internet service. All right, last two. Number 15, Cisco CPAM solution for police department. Whenever the police department building was built, there was a door lock solution put in place that was separate from the other door lock solutions we have on the rest of the city facilities. Now, it did it to make sure that there was segregation of that building and so forth, but we can actually provide that same segregation within the application we're using on all the rest of the facilities. So we actually got a request from the police department last year to any new doors to start putting in with the same system all the rest of the facilities has. It's one central management point. It overall will save us cost in the long run because of only one maintenance we're having to pay. The cabling is not proprietary to the system as it is today, so it's a lot cheaper to install. But this would allow us to retrofit the existing doors that are on the current system, because currently today we're running two systems over there. The new doors have the system that all the rest of the buildings have, and the old doors have the previous system. And then finally, item 16, very similar to accountants calling in an auditor to audit the books and make sure they're doing okay. We'd like to call in a security expert team to make sure that we're doing okay in the security we're providing. Y'all have heard about the issue with the city of Spring Hill, the issue recently with the city of Atlanta. We feel that we're doing a great job, but we also want to make sure that we're doing a great job. And we want to make sure that we're providing the most secure environment possible. So that's what item 16 is, security audit. With that, that is the end of our program enhancements and our budget. We're happy to field any questions you have.
Any questions?
Thank you.
All right.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Yes, sir.
And thank you for your department's help. Many times this year I've had problems.
Item 13, budget presentation, facilities management.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Everybody doing well? I know everybody probably wishes they were outside, so. I don't have a whole lot of my team out here because it takes an army to run a kingdom, so. They're out.
I'm not sure what that means.
Oh, gosh.
Well, taking care of all of our facilities.
Okay. Yeah, there you go.
We've had our share of drainage issues lately, so.
That's Middle Tennessee humor.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's
is that Southern
you
slang?
Might not, you might not understand.
An army to run, an army to run a kingdom.
Catch on.
Yeah. Thanks, Clyde. I think Michael's going to drive for us. So, 2019 budget, purpose of our department. As always, facilities are responsible for facilitation, design, planning, scheduling, maintenance, implementation of measures, and management of city facilities and projects, along with maintenance work and repair requests of all managed structures. Breathe. Our mission is to manage our city facilities in a sustainable and economical environment wherever possible. The department strives for a safe and healthy environment for all staff and the community within the facilities. We manage in the new structures that are built within the community. Our goal is always to implement a LEED format wherever possible in the construction and or remodeling of any city facility and the maintenance thereof. And I don't know if I've ever told you that Station 8, we did end up with a silver LEED certificate for that. So we strive hard to keep that LEED certificates up. My org chart is not changing this year. It stays the same. So personnel, we could probably just kind of go over past that. We still are working as diligently as we can. We're probably a little bit more spread out now. We're more involved with Sanitation Environmental Services facility, still with Public Works, PD, City Hall. Multiple fire halls, we're all involved with fire halls in regards to any remodeling or requests that they have. So we're getting spread out a little bit more, and currently my team is doing a great job with taking care of those folks. Operations, as discussed previously, the facilities continues working with the number of departments both within the City Hall and the surrounding area. As mentioned during last year's budget presentation, there's not a day that still something does not break down, is torn up, or just basically quits, especially this year with the harsh cold that we did have and the heat that will come about. This budget represents the cost for maintaining the current infrastructure in regards to operation, but looks to perform services on older facilities that are needing to be maintained and or major repairs. The budget presented also incorporates higher utility costs. Some of the current facilities we operate are full-time. With all facility comes the required test requirements, revision of existing maintenance contracts, updated IT infrastructure cost. And right here, I did mess this up. I do have a number that was wrong. I'm calling that is proposed to be about 3% more than the 2018 budget, and we are actually down this year. Our budget will be down 16.5%, if I read that correctly.
Your operations is just a little higher. So that
actually, it's all good.
So we are.
2.6. Yeah.
Okay.
But overall, you are correct.
Okay. Well, good. After following the IT enhancement, I feel pretty good. this due to carrying additional funds regarding the HVAC repairs, growing maintenance fees at our facilities, and some additional work needed around the City Hall campus. Our base budget in regards to capital, we will hope to continue with the $250,000 that we do keep in our budget for our architectural assessments and future of City Hall. Another program enhancement that I'm asking for is a new vehicle. As I spoke a moment ago about, we are taking on a little bit more work with other areas. Jim Maxwell is my lead man within City Hall. Kevin Faley has been with us now for a few years now. He's doing an excellent job, and Jim can pretty much send Kevin out on his own to do what he needs to do, but trying to pile stuff into a pickup truck because Jim's going one direction and Kevin needs to go another direction, gets hard on tools and trying to keep them all secure. So we are looking to possibly get another truck with a utility bed. We currently have two older pickup trucks, one that we just have to kind of disconnect the battery at night so we don't drain it down for the next day's use. Program enhancements. Do have some multiple program enhancements that we will go through. Facilities looking to carry those enhancements that the departments will be handling the work, as this department will be handling the work. At this time, we do not see any rollover of approved enhancements from 2018's budget moving into this year's. One area that was not approved was some remodeling to the HR and boardroom area. This work is only in an aspect of floor covering and painting. We're hoping to try to get HR and maybe some work in the boardroom done in 2019. HVAC repairs and replacements are now being carried as a line item. And you will see an enhancement here in a moment to try to have another line item. Every enhancement is considered the most important. It's felt at the City Hall in regards to roof repairs to City Hall. We're wanting to install or build an ADA ramp on the north side of City Hall because we are not currently able to, or a wheelchair is not currently able to access the lower square from our sidewalk elevation.
So that's here.
Right out this door here. The only way that ADA can go will be currently is Second Avenue and around through the Second Avenue garage entrance, and or with the construction of the project next door. They will have a sidewalk that will go through there, but it kind of ends up in their loading, unloading zone, and so it's some configuration areas in there. So while I was working with them in regards to that and looking at that, I thought we need to just go ahead and maybe place some money in for ADA, a ramp for here to get down. And we deal with, you know, ladies with the babies and the strollers and just a little bit more easy access for everybody. I did want to say that, yes, all the furniture, most of the furniture in Kevin's area in HR was whittled out of a single piece of oak, as he stated earlier, about the age of his area. And just in summary, there's always a lot going on with this facilities department regarding requests for enhancement and keeping the facilities up and functional. Current City of Franklin building infrastructures are still in good shape with exceptions to the requested enhancements. City Hall, as we continue to make it aesthetically pleasing to staff and citizens, is still going through age issues, and some items are starting to be additional problems. At least four HVAC units were replaced under the current 2018 budget, and it could be that many for 2019, along with multiple roof repairs and plumbing problems. As stated in the past, we will continue to take the funds that are provided and use them in the various wisest way possible while working to save funds however possible. So that's pretty, I'll go into my enhancements now.
Start. I'll pull it up.
Okay. City Hall roofs. We still deal with some major work around here. We need to fix some areas around some drains. Like I did last year, we added an additional line item to the budget for HVAC replacements. This year, I've asked Eric and the city to look at adding a $30,000 amount of money so that we can at times go around and make some of these repairs, because some of the repairs, when we get into them, they're $4,000, $5,000, and $6,000 repairs because the insulation has already gone bad up underneath the membrane, so you have to replace all of that to get it to feed into the drains as needed. I spoke a moment ago about the north entrance sidewalk or the ADA ramp there. We have, when we did the public works facility about 3 years ago,
We didn't really incorporate or have any roof repairs there. It's a metal roof. We do are starting to have some problems around some gutters and some seams, just different parts of the building that's starting to leak in a little bit into the building, but nothing that's major. We don't have any major leaks, just trying to button it up a little bit more. With the 3 years over at Public Works, we have a lot of folks that work in that facility, as y'all are aware of. You've been there for lunches and so, and we need to kind of spruce it up a little bit with some painting in the main stairwells in the first floor area. A little bit upstairs, but mainly in building number one. Remodel of the fire station four's kitchen. We've tried to do this over the last couple of years between fire and facilities to try to find the money. Haven't really had the money in the past, so this year I went ahead and placed $42,000 as an enhancement. The IT department folks have come to me, and we would like to try to get their entire team down to the south end of the facility, down by where they're located at now. There's a large room down there that planning currently uses for a storage room. And hopefully with some of the, if they can start doing some scanning with the planning department with a lot of their plans, we can try to get that emptied out fairly possible. So we're requesting to develop that planning storage room into offices for IT. Fire stations number 3 and 4, I'm asking to go in and remodel at least the men's restroom area, the locker areas. When they were designed with corner showers. So it's not like a full 3x3 shower. It's kind of a corner shower that's cut in half. So you can only imagine what they deal with and trying to get in there, some of those guys, and take baths. Sir?
Not the description.
Not the description. I could stand up and show, but
those are not together.
It's a large man. Next, we did talk about the vehicle replacement, and we can move on from that. I did speak to the remodeling of the HR front space in the boardroom area over there of $23,000. Station 6, where we have been dealing with leaks over there in the past few years. I think most of all of our leaks are now taken care of. There's quite a few ceiling tiles and some work that needs to be done to try to clean the ceilings up in that one of our newer facilities. Number 11 was putting some paint on the exterior of Station 5, on the interior and exterior. And over at PD, we are about 9 years old on our gate systems over there. So we're looking to try to do some hardware, not just hardware to the gate structures themselves, but some hardware and control system changes. Every now and then we'll have a gate that will go down, but we just got some nuts and bolts that are starting to kind of break loose, and so we fix those. But other than that, that's about my presentation. Any questions?
Well, does that relate to the presentation previous where we were monitoring the doors or changing the doors?
No,
out?
Sir. No, it's a complete system. It's automatic. It's automated when they come in and go out of the facility. Okay.
The parking in particular parking. Behind the building, there's that parking structure behind the police building. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
And there are gates from a couple different entrances.
Mm-hmm.
There.
Right. Get a lot of use.
IT is their enhancement is regarding the doors, the actual doors inside.
Access control system.
Inside the PD
their
building.
Key card.
Okay. That it?
Thank you.
Item 14. Thank y'all.
Thank you.
Thanks.
It is 3:18 p.m. We just want to be mindful of the fact that this is your longest Budget and Finance Committee meeting of the year. We still have five more budget presentations, and there's
you'll
a little bit of meat
minutes?
To some of them. This might be a good place to take 5 minutes.
Let's take five.
Okay.
I mean, I have no objections whatsoever.
It probably is a good time to take a break.
That's satisfactory.
Yeah, thanks.
All right. We're back. Michael, you're up. Finance. Christine,
team
you're
effort.
Up. Yeah. Finance. Mike, you're up. Whichever one, I'll get
I'm very happy to introduce my team with the finance department. My colleagues, Mike Lowe, our comptroller, and Michael Walters-Young, our budget and strategic innovation manager. And I believe Mike's going to start, and Michael will also be joining with Mike, and I'm here as well. So.
Good afternoon. I'd like to start by thanking members of the finance team for being in the audience this afternoon.
Wave your hand back there. We know who really does the work.
They are the audience.
They need to sit to the front and make the building room look fuller.
That was it, yeah.
Oh, dear.
What I'd like to do is follow the standard outline, which includes the purpose of the department, the organization, the personnel, and operations. But I would like to go ahead and mention at this point that we have no capital request for 2019. And then after I cover those sections, I was going to ask Michael if he could cover the program enhancements as well as the summary for us. If you look at the purpose of the finance department, we do everything from budget to financial reporting to vendor payments, to payroll. We know we have vendors and employees that are very happy about those last two functions. We do the city's investments. We help with the bond issues. So a lot of the financial services are provided by the finance department. And one thing I ask is, as we were talking about budget, I asked our accounts payable person, I said, it appears our mailing costs are down. And what she told me is, she says, what we've tried to do is go electronic. So if we're making direct deposit payments, mm-hmm. instead of actually then sending out the remittance, we now do that by email. So that's been one of the things that have actually reduced some of the operating costs within the finance department. In the organization chart, the finance department has 9 full-time employees and 3 part-time employees. And one of those part-time employees is our former assistant city administrator, Russ Truel. He helps us with pension, he helps us with RFPs, so basically it's been valuable having his assistance with our department.
Is that the investment officer?
Yes. Yes, he is the investment officer. And he is actually one of 2 retirees that we have that are helping us in the finance department.
The other part-time financial manager is a retiree. Who provides very key services for us on a part-time basis.
When you look at personnel and you notice the percentage like Michael talked about, and it appears it was going up 9%, I wanted to at least go through why that increase. And the first is we had a fourth financial analyst budgeted for half a year. For 2019, that position will be budgeted for the entire year. Mm-hmm. And for Russ Truel's pay, it was actually budgeted in the general expenses in 2018, so it will actually be budgeted directly into the finance budget in 2019. And the other thing is they keep looking at positions. There's a few market adjustments, primarily our financial analyst positions. So in essence, all of those together are what accounts for the difference you see right here. In operations, and I know we have a negative like you've seen in earlier departments, and the one thing I would like to maybe highlight is that the increase you see is primarily from where we have renewed contracts with PFM that helps us with bonds, as well as government portfolio analysis, is that correct? GPA?
Advisors.
And what it is, they help us with investments. And the next thing that we want to do is we want to put in a small amount, and we estimate about $3,000 that would help us with a dissemination agent, because right now with bond compliance, mm-hmm. post-issuance, it's one, the SEC is even getting involved in trying to make sure you're in compliance. So we thought that cost would help us just to ensure that we are in compliance with all of those requirements. So that's included within operations. And at that point, what I'd like to do is maybe turn it over to Michael and let him look at our program enhancements for 2019.
Thank you, Mike. Finance Department is requesting three additional enhancements to its budget. The first is a one-time expense, which would be to continue building out the office. If you haven't had a chance to come down to our neck of the woods recently, you'll notice that things look a little different.
Mm-hmm.
We went through a major office renovation during fiscal 18. We're very grateful for the new digs. They've been very well received. One of the benefits of the office renovations is that we now have an additional conference room. We'll be getting that online. So there will be conference room directly across the hall adjacent to the boardroom, which will get plugged in and available for internal as well as external meetings. That this $10,000 would be simply to add some additional technology to that conference room and to a separate breakout space which we've created in the middle of our offices, which will allow us to do sort of smaller projects but smaller breakout groups and not take up the conference room, but then access our archives. We've tried to centralize a lot of our bookcases and additional files that we have in this center space to make it easier and to allow ourselves to break things out and really just kind of have a more, we'll call it modern office, as opposed to the offices we had before. The second item is a request not just on behalf of the finance department, quite honestly. It's something we've talked about for a while now within the capital projects group that meets every other Wednesday morning. we are requesting roughly $20,000, and we're waiting still for an exact quote from our vendor that does our open performance site, Socrata, to look at something called Capital Projects Explorer. Right now, you all know that we provide you a CIP and provide you updates to that CIP. But there's not one centralized place that you can access on a variety of platforms to tell you what the status of capital projects are in the city of Franklin. Mm. The technology is out there to do that. Now, we haven't engaged upon this yet because we're working internally to make sure that our capital project accounting is as streamlined and accurate as possible, and to make sure that the timeliness of information that we give to you, as well as we're able to monitor our projects, is really the way it should be. To that end, I would like to introduce the newest member of our finance team, Chris Lynch. Wave. There you go. Chris is our fourth financial analyst. We converted our administrative assistance position to a financial analyst. Chris comes to us from Kirkland, Washington, just outside of Seattle. And one of the projects he did in the 4 years he worked for the city of Kirkland Finance Department was to overhaul their city's capital project accounting. So guess what one of his projects is going to be for the city of Franklin.
Welcome, Chris.
This tool and the tools we've looked at would allow us to be able to integrate our GIS and our finances and the engineering updates so that you'd be able to click on it with one click or search on water-funded projects, search on Invest Franklin-funded projects, search on property tax-funded projects, whatever it may be, by quadrant, by street, whatever it may be. It was also designed that you'd be able to do it on any mobile device. We think that this is just a very, very good, transparent investment because it would get all of you timely information that you'd be able to share with the citizens, and you'd be able to point them and say, here's the status of this project. It's either ahead of schedule, it's behind schedule, it's under budget, it's over budget. And you know, we'd work with, once we set up things, to see what the frequency of updates and those sorts of things would be.
What kind of time frame should we expect this?
I would say at least the beginning of the calendar year. We would wait, of course, to get the budget approved. Yeah. It's going to require at least several months worth of work on the inside capital project accounting. We're not even going to begin this until, obviously, the budget is done. So I would say we would want until at least the beginning of January 2019 before we would be eligible, I think, to even consider having this rolled out. But we would want to secure the funds to be able to procure it. You can certainly go online and search various other cities. City of Seattle uses the same tool. City of Topeka, Kansas uses the same tool. There's other vendors than Socrata as well. So we would not we know the platform and we know what it can do, but certainly you can go in and see. And if there's one that you find that's of interest in a city, please send it our way, and we'll certainly evaluate it and evaluate the vendor. The final program enhancement is to add an additional position within the finance department, and that would be for a data analyst. This is a request we made last year, and the idea behind this person is that this would be an additional individual who would be chiefly responsible for mining data within the city. There's a lot of discussion over the last several years about big data. We formed, in response to this interest, the city's first data analytics team, which is myself, Jordan Shaw, Jason Potts, Ryan Tate, and Wayne Goode, and Chris Robinson. So GIS, database, SharePoint, IT, and the connection to finance and analytics. And our goal really is to have someone who'd be able to take all of our data and be a go-to person to mine the data, to take a look at trends. We think this is going to be an increasingly important position for the city to leverage its data to the fullest extent possible moving forward. It is number 3 of 3 on the priority list, and there's still a lot of additional work we have to do. Probably it's not going to get funded this year, but you're going to keep seeing it until we get the position on, because we think it's something that you will need certainly in the near, if not slightly medium term. Next year, in summary, the finance department is poised to continue its role in supporting all of you, the various boards, citizens, and taxpayers who have come to deliver, who have come to expect the high quality of services that we deliver. We are proud of our accomplishments, as you can see them up there. Last year's audit, once again, had 0 audit findings. For the 10th consecutive year, the city is the award recipient of the Distinguished Budget Presentation Award from the GFOA. And for the 26th consecutive year, the city has received the Certificate of Achievement for Excellence in Financial Reporting. We are proud of these accomplishments, and as we always do, we'll try to do a little bit better next year, but we like to keep a good thing going. We will stand or sit for any questions you may have.
Any questions or comments from any committee member? Michael, Mike, Christine, thank you.
Thank you all.
Item 15, budget presentation appropriations.
And I got 2 copies of this, so I hope that didn't mean somebody
some extra.
Somebody didn't get one.
As you know, the board and the city has a history of supporting some outside organizations for various community services and public purposes. We've provided that list. Our general approach has been to maintain level funding, with the exception of 2 elements that are included that we are assuming funding on, one being animal control because it's a contracted service and this is a continuation of that arrangement. And the other is the 91X bus service support, which we knew a year ago when we improved it that it would take this incremental step up in cost, and had anticipated that, so we assumed we would go ahead and continue that as a base budget item. So those 2 items are in. Everything else that was an increase above what their current funding, we have looked at as a program enhancement.
Where are the people parking now for the bus?
At the Ag Center.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
That seems to be working okay. We had some concern if that would be a good location or not. It seems to be working fairly well. So and ridership, I believe, continues to be pretty strong with that. This is a jump up in the subsidy provided locally. It's based on, I think they had been targeting some federal grant dollars to help offset that cost, and that's a
decline here. Jump.
Yeah. It was more of a one-time grant, and now that's dropped off.
And we're trying to go back and get the I've lost the
CMAC.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Trying to find some more CMAC money, so that number could come down.
Okay. And in full disclosure, they had notified this. They notified us of this last year.
Yes,
at this
they
time.
Did. Mm-hmm. I didn't remember it was this big, but I knew it was bigger.
Yeah. So the only increases are thanks to those 2 adjustments. We did have a piece drop off because our portion of the
Southern Corridor study was funded, fully funded this year, so that drops off, but those two do create this net increase in the total dollar amount in our, what we're calling the base budget. And then on the last page, you just see the list of either new requests or increased requests over existing funding that we received from seven different organizations. So, that's something we'll look at, and it ranges from $100 to $10,000. So we weren't sure how else to differentiate, but to just go ahead and say anybody who is above what they got this year, we would consider as an enhancement and just identify that for you.
What's the process? Is there an evaluation criteria the city goes through, or is there a committee that decides which civic organizations?
Really not. I mean, these are really, some of them are very much tied to a partnership in terms of services. Okay. Things like Bridges, they assist us with a response to domestic violence and other needs there, and so that just sort of works that way. Obviously, the animal control is similar in that way. Mm-hmm. Others are really just, there's been a history of the city providing some support to those social gotcha. Service agencies, and so we've really continued that. It's something we sort of struggle a little bit every year about, how much do we open it up for other, there are many, many worthy organizations to work with in the community and how you differentiate. And these are ones we've just had a history with working with them and providing some level of support. So that's really how we've gotten to where we are right now.
So. There is some historical data someplace mm-hmm. about the percentage that we provide each organization and the amount of funding that we go into. I'm not sure where that is. I know that that was probably in 2005, somewhere along in there. The only thing I'd say to this is you might want to look at the percentage of increase mm-hmm. and only say we would only be looking at 10% increase over your last year's budget. Mm-hmm. And I'm only making that number up. Mm-hmm. It can be anything you want to. But you might want to just because you're going to be doing the same thing next year.
Yeah.
And it'll be the amount, same amount or whatever it is next year also. So there probably needs to be some rationale for approving some of those over there we struggle with this every year because it's
That's
always, because
right.
it's all of them are worthy.
That's
and,
right.
Exactly. Yeah. Right. But,
there well, and there's a couple that dropped off, so like.
Yeah, well, the J.O. Clay Senior Citizen Center dropped off. That was the biggest appropriation on there. They mm-hmm. dropped off, but you're going to the
center.
But you're going to the Enrichment Center now. Mm-hmm. So you've got the Enrichment Center, Williamson County Enrichment Center, providing the same services and a lot more services than what the Clay Center was providing. So
gotcha. And we did make a capital contribution to that facility.
Yes, we did.
And
mm-hmm.
now are no longer doing the operating support that we did.
Very, very handsome capital.
One thing I should have mentioned, we do a contract with every one of these organizations that establishes the public purpose and the specific programs and elements we're funding. They also provide us with annual audit and financial reports and all those. So we do have a basic accountability with each of these organizations that we establish and you make sure we monitor so those dollars are being used for what their the stated purpose.
And that information goes to the finance department. So if you want to look at that, if you want to look at one particular organization, you could see their staffing, their funding, should be able to.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think all their 990s are public information
yeah.
if you
mm-hmm.
want
yeah.
to look at any of them.
And some of them are kind of on their own.
Yeah, we request the process such as it is in February of each year we send out letters from the finance department to all agencies that have received funding the prior year, and if there's someone new that has come forward to request, we'll gladly facilitate that and send it out to them. At bare minimum, they have to fill out a city form as well as provide state information. So it can be the simplified form that the state just passed last year, which is a two-page form summarizing their financial information. It can be their full audit, Williamson County Library submitted the county's audit as their documentation. That's a little bit more than was necessary, but okay. Everything we received this year from the all agencies is loaded into Granicus. So
okay.
Rather than printing it for all of you, which it came to, and Chris can vouch for this, 300-400 odd pages,
right.
we wanted to make sure you had access to it, but leave it in the electronic netherworld.
Any other questions or comments on appropriations? All right, then let's go to economic development, item 16.
This is similar. These are organizations we support that have more of an economic development related mission. We have incorporated, again, either level funding or I know a couple of them are based on population and sort of a formula in that way, but you've got the economic development support for the Chamber of Commerce, Williamson, Inc., and they're specifically the economic development program, and then a specific business retention and attraction program. So you've got those two, which totals $45,000. They are our one program enhancement. They are in the midst of they do a periodic campaign for some additional dollars in terms of support, and they have made a request for an additional, I believe it's $10,000 of funding for the economic development efforts of the Williamson, Inc. Chamber. So that has been requested. We have looked at that as a program enhancement. The other elements are more regional agencies that we are part of, including the Greater Nashville Regional Council, the Nashville Area Chamber of Commerce, and the MPO, the Metropolitan Planning Organization.
Any questions?
Glad to take any other questions.
So that the Williamson Inc. would be an additional, because I see down there got the retention and development.
The request that's been made is that $20,000 figure would go to 30.
That's what I was thinking.
And it's really part of their broader economic development fundraising campaign that they've just launched. And I think their intent is that would be an annual increase. It wouldn't just be this year. It would be we would step up our level of support.
That's probably pretty accurate.
Yeah.
The county government also.
The county, their entire economic development department has been outsourced to that organization, and it's somewhere around $400,000
because that's
the staffing that had been county employees that are now part of the economic development office at Williamson Inc., and they support that directly with a contribution by the county.
They did a pro forma using our sheets, which is attached to your program enhancement and the particular item. So they're forecasting expenditures, but it's the total of Williamson Inc. Of over $1 million this year. The request for the city in this particular element is, you know, going from $20,000 to $30,000. So
we
be that as
ways.
Right.
Tax dollars.
You know, that's an interesting comment, because we pay the county taxes, we pay the city taxes both, so you get hammered on both. I shouldn't say hammered, that's not a good word, I don't guess. It's probably not a finance word. We are able to participate on both ends.
Well, I guess we should think, though, that when you think about economic development, Franklin's got a big portion of that versus some other areas in Williamson County, can we say?
The lion's share of employment and of the development activity is occurring in Franklin. Mm-hmm. It's happening in other places too, but it is we're by far the largest benefactor of those economic development.
So would the City of Spring Hill have a line item similar to this?
I don't know if they're asking them. I'm not sure that there's a direct support from those cities.
What part
I've not seen that.
Spring Hill is in Williamson.
They don't itemize. On this pro forma that's in your packets, they itemize the contribution from Williamson County, which is the actuals for 2017, just looking at an actual year. The Williamson County contributed $295,000. We contributed $20,000. They earned $3,317.01 of interest. And then they list capital campaign amounts of $600,000, roughly. So I don't know.
That's the city of Brentwood. They have a line.
See, that's, they're not itemizing it here.
Okay.
They may, but I don't, do not know.
Well, I know, was it on the part about the animal control where they had written out the parts mm-hmm. of,
you know, the animal controls is a little different.
I know it is, but what I'm saying is, mm-hmm. though, it had that thing where it said,
it went by 30, city by
30%, yeah. mm-hmm. Franklin, 25%, all the rest, I mean, no, no, Williamson County, and then it had specific percentages for the other cities.
The animal control, all but the I know local that's governments different. Who agree to participate, sure. they actually allocate by population.
Yes.
And we, most of that increase was we did have a special census and had to, mm-hmm. and we, of course, reported that population increase. And as other jurisdictions who participate complete special census, that could shift a little bit. But we'll see how that goes. Mm-hmm.
But they had done, I knew they had done it somewhere, yes, ma'am. And I was remembering mm-hmm. it was.
Item 17, budget presentation, miscellaneous general fund, departments, general expense, and inter-fund transfers.
I'll go ahead and take the next two items.
Okay. So we're doing 17 and 18 both now.
I'll do 17 and then we'll move
yeah,
right.
Yeah, and then just, do 18.
But I'll go ahead and spearhead the presentation for the next two. General expenses is, these two items are the last two items you have yet to see that are budgeted within the general fund. So starting with general expenses, these are expenses which are deemed, wait for it, general in nature, and are not particularly attributable to one department. These include the base amount of general wage increases for the year. If you remember, we budget here, and then once it's determined how much we can afford and the method with which we will base wage increases for the upcoming year, we then use the first budget amendment of the year to distribute these funds out mm-hmm. to departments, rather than putting the money in departments mm-hmm. where we're still in a position of trying to build a budget and we don't know how much money will be available for wage increases. Some years, none. Some years, more than none. We budget it here. It's just simpler that way, and then we can have one place to go to and then pull them out. The city's appropriations for medical, dental, and vision expenses.
Oh, yeah.
There's a lot of detail that's attached to your detailed budget in this, but we mm-hmm. Set up a system so that we have one place where we can track those expenses, and that ends up being here in the general expense category. They're itemized and distributed amongst the departments, but they then all roll back up into this one place, and they roll out of this one place from an accounting standpoint. That also helps us as a check to be able to show that when we work with our benefits consultant for the year, we can make sure that we're capturing all of the additional items, stop loss, consultants' fees, any taxes we may incur, those sorts of things. Those are all itemized within general expenses. Our dues for TML, the general fund share of the annual audit, fuel hedging, citizen survey, the open performance site, and our contribution participation for the Tennessee Municipal Benchmarking Project. Last year, you added an approved a program enhancement for $100,000 for the support of various housing initiatives. We are proposing in the base budget that be maintained for fiscal 19. Not enhanced, but maintained to give you at least some degree of leverage or seed money for anything that may come up in the next year. You can see, again, lies and damn statistics. It's a rather large increase. And the reason why it's 182.7% increase is because the budget amount each year gets moved out for the wage increase. Now, the wage increase is the single largest item which is budgeted here. Mm-hmm. So you see it's, you know, total personnel costs, which include the benefits and they include the wages, is $2.4 million, but the budget for 2018 is $690,000. Last year, the budget was close to $2.4 million, and that's because when we transfer those wages out, they get moved into the individual departments. General fund does not change, does not go up or down any, but it creates this very weird, very momentary large percentage anomaly within this department. Everybody understands that? Okay. Any questions on general expenses? There is one program enhancement, and that is, there was a request made, if you remember, we've done a lot of work over the last 12 months, certainly the last eight, working with our consultant, Steve Thompson, looking at virtually every position within the city to see where they are in the competitive marketplace. There's large wage adjustments. You've seen market adjustments in these PowerPoints over the last 3 months in a lot of departments, because certain positions needed to get upgraded, grades needed to change, and we've changed the bands, 5% and 5% effective January 1 and July 1 for general fund employees, 10% automatically for police and fire. The request was made, we thought we would do this over a 3-year period, that we would take on public safety in fiscal 18, we would take on public works in fiscal 19, and we would take on everybody else in fiscal 20. However, board members made the request to see how much would it cost to try to do it all in fiscal 19. The balance is $186,207 for, shall we say, the rest of us in this room who are general fund employees, the general government. The public works amounts are already built into the FY19 base.
Okay.
Because that's what we said we would do.
Yeah.
Obviously, so too is the police and fire that already happened in fiscal 18. That's been continued. So the amount of money that would be necessary in addition to take care of the rest of the general government employees is $186,207.
So when you were talking about phasing it in, the comment was, maybe not even request, but the comment was that we would like to see the third phase moved up to at least the second level.
This is what it costs to do that.
Okay.
So, which we'd really like to try to do if it all, we're still crunching numbers and working through budget, but we'd like to try to do that if at all possible, so that we can get that. And while it was over three budgets, it would have been done over 18 months. This would allow us to do it over 6 months for everybody in terms of making those market adjustments.
Let's see if we can make that happen.
I would wholeheartedly recommend that, support that.
We will do our best to make that happen.
Gonna keep.
Let me do note, one of the things Michael was talking about, medical insurance and those elements. We are very fortunate that our costs are projecting out to be flat for next year in terms of health insurance. That's the first time in a while. So we are very thankful. You know, our HR teams worked hard on looking at that. We did some things with structuring of those plans. We talked about a true high deductible plan as an option for our folks. And our experience was really, really good this last year. So that all rolled together gives us an opportunity to really remain flat, and that's gonna be very helpful in putting this budget together.
The final item in the general fund that you have yet to see is interfund transfers. These are simply transfers that come from the general fund. Oftentimes they are budgeted or amended within the budget at the end of the year that go out to other funds. The two traditional transfers are the ones which you see up here and are included in the fiscal 19 budget, totaling $1.2 million. That is a transfer to the Sanitation Environmental Services Fund of $250,000. As you well know, certain years that's been higher, especially 10 years ago, it was $4.4 million. And we've been averaging around $500,000 to $750,000 the last 3 years. So we're going to start at $250,000, but there's a lot of moving pieces still. As we put this budget to bed, certainly Mark and Jack have been working hard on and doing a deeper analysis regarding cost of services and efficiencies within sanitation, and we're going to keep that in mind as we look at this. And then the second component is the city's subsidy to the transit fund. If you go back to the beginning of this meeting, you'll remember that the 34% of the transit budget comes from the city. Well, that has to be budgeted somewhere from the city, and this is where it is budgeted. There are other transfers which have come out of this fund. over years past, and that includes transfers to the Road Impact Fund, transfers to the Capital Projects Fund, transfers to the Street Aid Fund. This is the accounting mechanism we use from a budgeting perspective when we need to move money from the general fund to a different fund. So that's why last year there were five or six or seven funds that we made transfers to at year end, totaling $4.6 million, and we only plan on budgeting $1.2 million for next year because there's only the two transfers we plan to make at this time. Questions?
You doing 18 too?
I am doing 18.
Oh, wait a minute. Oh, okay. Yeah, that's where I am.
Well, let me read the caption on 18. Budget presentation, other development growth fund, city facilities tax, county facilities tax fund, road impact fund, hotel motel tax fund, in lieu of parkland fund.
Mm-hmm. And then at the end of the day.
Yeah.
You only have six more funds to go, and then you will have seen the entire budget. Christine will end with the debt service fund in a moment when I am done. But I want to take a few minutes with you today and talk about our anticipated forecasts for these five development and or growth related funds. We lump these together because we want to wait until April. Experience has shown us to try to get a better idea of our forecasts for revenues, because it's dependent upon development, with the exception of hotel motel. Road impact, parkland, and the two facilities taxes are directly tied to development. That means a couple of things. Number one, take these estimates with an asterisk because it's totally dependent upon the development in the community and when permits are pulled and how quickly we can receive those funds. However, Lynn Osland does an awesome job and I sit with her. She develops a model every year in late March, because we try to get 9 months into the year, looking at every development that's in the pipeline, every development that we think is in the pipeline. So people who have come in and done sort of pre-hearings and just come to us with ideas. And then we take an estimate of all of the permit fees that are going to be generated. Building permit fees, facilities taxes, road impact funds, both collector and arterial now, and parkland funds, to see what we can anticipate in the next year. Being fiscally conservative as we are, we then take that estimate and we ratchet it down. This year I used a factor of about 75% of Lynn's estimates, because again, it's a wide degree of variation.
You cannot tell.
Okay. That all being said. The first fund to look at is the city's facilities tax. This was authorized by a private act of the Tennessee General Assembly in 1987. And it levies a tax on new development designed that it contribute its fair share to provide new public facilities made necessary by growth. It is limited, however, in how we can use it, because such taxes may only be spent on police, fire, sanitation, and parks and recreation expenditures. Such expenses can only be spent on expenses related to growth, meaning that if we have a trash packer that is old, we cannot replace it using facilities tax funds. However, if we have a trash packer and we've grown in population, we have to add a new route, we can use facilities tax funds for that purpose.
For the equipment.
For the equipment. Not the people.
For the people.
Not the people. But this can pay for equipment and it can pay for capital investment. Your new fire stations are being paid for out of the facilities tax. And to that end, our forecast for fiscal 19 is about $2.5 million in revenues. Now again, there's lots of projects. We estimate we'll probably collect about $4.5 million this year. We had a conservative estimate of $3.8 million last year, which is just right in line with the amount we collected in fiscal 17. Could be higher, could be a little lower. It's our best guess. The $5.37 million, however, is costs pertaining to Station 7, both equipment and the cost of the station itself. That number is probably going to be lower than $5.37 million. We had budgeted, you'll note there's $5.2 million budgeted in fiscal 18. We had anticipated expensing more of that project in the current fiscal year. That's not going to happen. There's been a lot more, there's just been a lot of, we won't call them issues, but there's just been things that have come up in trying to get that project off the ground.
The site.
The site.
Working with the county and the site and the relocation of some significant power lines in that area. We've had to work through that. We think we're pretty much there. Brad is estimating we will bid that fire station in May.
So really, what we,
so it's really
what
all
we budgeted,
land
yeah,
in the next year yeah plus.
And we can then, you know, we can see what those costs are. If they are dramatically higher or lower, we'll make an amendment in budget amendment number one. But sure, this gets us a large portion of the way without having to come back to you with an amendment.
Michael, correct me if I'm wrong. This cost includes the county component that they're going to help pay for.
Correct.
We're siting an EMS unit and living quarters for paramedics there, and they're gonna reimburse us or contribute that portion of the project. So this is an all-inclusive cost.
Correct.
But we have to show that because we're going to foot the bill mm-hmm initially.
It's our project,
yeah,
and they'll reimburse us for their portion.
Yeah. The second fund to look at is the county facilities tax. This is a new special revenue fund. We created it at the end of fiscal 17. We budgeted for it for the first time this year in fiscal 18. It is our share of the county's adequate school facilities tax. 30% of the proceeds are distributed to cities within the county, and another 30% is divided pro rata among the incorporated cities based upon the last decennial census. We began collecting a share of this tax in fiscal 2012. Prior to last year, monies collected had been deposited within Fund 310, the Capital Projects Fund. If you recall, we came to you asking for you, and you were supportive of us being able to take it out because it just makes it easier to know how much we have in the fund and how much we've collected over time from the county facilities tax. We're estimating the same amount of revenues we got last year, or this year, next year. We do have a higher amount in 2018. Again, it's highly dependent upon development and highly dependent upon what the county's collections are. We have no expenses forecast at this time. However, that will change as we work through tier two of the capital improvement plan and refining tier one with you in the ensuing months. That $900,000 this year included $300,000 for Henpeck Lane, $500,000 for Hillsborough Road Phase 2, and $100,000 for Long Lane and Peytonsville Road lights.
Oh, yeah,
and
yeah,
and improvements and traffic improvements at that intersection.
Okay.
Again, what we have tried to do is only use these funds in areas that are close to or projects that the city takes on related to county facilities. So the Ag Center, that would be the $100,000 that I just spoke of. Henpeck Lane was to extend sewer to a new county school site, and Hillsborough Road Phase 2, sidewalks and streetlights and, sidewalks and traffic signals and those sorts of things adjacent to Franklin High.
Well, the Henpeck Lane sewer was, what, 1.2 or 3 million?
1.2.
Yeah, we're paying
was
half. Some of that may land in 19. We need to take a look at that.
Okay.
With Paul.
The vote,
yeah,
the what you mm-hmm did was to say that the $300,000 of our commitment would come from county facilities. So that's the expense that's reflected here,
okay,
towards that project. And that was simply a transfer over to the Water and Sewer Fund because that's
right,
the project is being managed and expensed out of that fund. But we can certainly make sure that we've got enough money in 19.
That's good.
The third fund is the Road Impact Fund. The Road Impact Fund is a special revenue fund created for the accounting of expenditures in accord with Ordinance 88-13, for the proceeds of road impact fees on new development. We took a look at this in 2011, and we took a look at it very recently. For the costs that can be paid for new arterial roads, and of course, we've now started collecting it for collector roadways. These funds can be used also for the payment of debt service and bonds associated with large projects, road projects. So the $8 million figure you see here for next year does include monies for both arterial and collectors. That's broken out in your detailed budgets. The $5.2 million worth of expenditures are a transfer to the debt service fund as well as our estimate of road impact offset agreements. If you will go back in time to last year, you'll remember that we, for the first time, presented a budget that actually appropriated offset agreements, because we have gone to a pattern of when we collect road impact fees, we try to collect them all and hold on to them. And then we do a quarterly true-up with developers and the development projects. If they have expensed money to build the roads, they can get some of their money back. We have to keep enough of that money available, though, to cut the checks for that offset when that true-up occurs, which is why you now have several million dollars appropriated. Last year, I think we budgeted about $3.4 million or $3.5 million. This year, it's closer to $2.5 based upon a little bit more experience in doing it this way. The design of with this, though, is to add transparency to show that we've collected large amounts of revenues and we are actually going to be expensing it out. Prior to this, we had it as a credit or an offset all within revenue, and so you never really knew how much revenue you'd be collecting versus what you would be expensing back out. You will also note in fiscal 18, there's $7.4 million estimated in expense. Next year, we haven't budgeted for it yet, but we are looking at coming to you in May. If you remember, the Capital Projects Fund has a deficit. Part of our way to close out that deficit is to make transfers from fund balance of the Road Impact Fund to close out that deficit. So there are expenses that are here in 18, which we may do again in 19, but we, in order to get the Fund 310 to zero or near zero, by the end of fiscal 19, but we're gonna wait and see how well we perform in 19, if there's sufficient fund balance, we feel comfortable to do that.
And so it's- just a little, just one quick point of clarification. These were capital road projects that were completed several years ago, mm-hmm. that funding was not identified at that time, and then we came with a plan to reimburse the capital project fund for those road projects over about a 3-year period, and that's what we're, when Michael's talking about perhaps being able to do that over 2 years rather than 3 years, those are the same road projects that we had talked to the board about last year.
And we also at this point have not stated that on the collectors, that's going to have to be spent in the area. And I'm looking here, it looks like so far we've only collected something from area 2 and area 3.
Correct.
In the mm-hmm. for the collector road impact.
You'll note there's a large distinction or there's a large amount forecast for fiscal 19 that's based upon Lynn's estimates of what would be collector versus arterial. Mm-hmm. Again, there's such wild mm-hmm. swings potential from this estimate. I ask that you take it with an asterisk.
I was going to say, between 11,000 and 3.1
right.
million.
Yeah. Right. So
that's pretty wild.
But it's you know, the details there, and we can certainly show it to anyone that wants to look at it. It's just a question of, will those developments occur in that time frame? And if they don't, then...
Oh, I've got a question.
They don't. Yes, ma'am.
Are those areas exactly the same as the parkland areas, or are they different?
I think they're very similar.
I think they're very similar, but I don't
when we
know.
Talk.
Oh, did you? Okay.
I think
we need to look at those
very
two
similar.
Maps.
I don't know if they're exactly the
let's
same,
look at
but
those,
I think they're.
Let's compare those two.
They're
maps.
Generally very close.
Yep.
Okay.
It would be very convenient if they were the same.
It would
be easier to manage that way, but yeah. We need to look at that.
But anyway, yeah, that occurred to me.
We had a discussion at our department heads meeting this morning about making sure in the future you will see far more detail in revenues for both parkland and road impact, because we will make sure to show you those collections of the quadrants. At this point in time, though,
they were
in
that thing from Tuesday night, but
yeah.
On the parkland, but mm-hmm. you had to kind of fish it.
Yep.
Well, no, I think they were mm-hmm. that not only were they identified individually, they also were aggregated per
by quadrant.
Per quadrant, yeah.
Any questions on order?
Oh wait, let me see. I see if I can have said that about the quadrants and. You've talked about trying to pay off the debt on the, what is it called, 310 or something like that.
Mm-hmm. the deficit, yes, ma'am.
Yeah, the deficit there. I shouldn't say debt.
The deficits, we no longer have a capital project fund that in total is in deficit as of June 30th of 2017 because we closed the 2017 exactly. bond yeah. issue on June the 26th.
Yeah,
so
right.
the fund itself had a positive balance on June the 30th, but we did have this plan to work through on some of those large road projects that had been completed a couple of years before. And certainly we continue to spend the bond proceeds from the 2007 issuance, and that those must be expended within 3 years of June 26, 2017. So we're just planning these transfers along with the planned expenditure of the bond issue, but we of course have to make sure that at the end of every fiscal year that fund has a positive balance.
And you're still going to talk about hotel motel?
I am.
Good. Okay. I've got a question on that too, but all right.
The Hotel Motel Tax Fund, which is a special revenue fund used to account for the locally administered tax levied upon the occupancy of hotel and motel rooms, in addition to the sales tax. The City of Franklin rate is 4% of a maximum 5% under state law. The fund has been used in the past to pay debt service on the conference center, which you heard earlier, but two and a half hours ago, has now been retired, as well as costs on Harlansdale and for Battlefield Parks. The funds are used primarily and increasingly over the years for tourism and tourist-related capital projects. The budget includes 1% of the 4% tax based upon collections from the calendar year, says 2013, but it's the last one, to support the Convention and Visitors Bureau. We are forecasting about a gross 4.1% increase in revenues. It's about a 4%, 3.94% in the hotel rate, I'm sorry, the hotel motel tax collections. But you'll see in a lot of these funds much larger interest income amounts. And that's just because as rates have gone up and the fund balances have gone up, we are simply recognizing and seeing more interest earned. Still not a lot in reference to the fund itself, but it's important to acknowledge the revenues as we see them. The expenses shown only include the expenses for the Convention and Visitors Bureau and fixed debt service payments. There's also the payments, I don't remember what year we're in. This is either year four for Carter's Hill of yes. seven. $214,286 is the okay. annual payment, and this is year four. It may only be year three, but it's a seven-year commitment the city has for that acquisition. And
okay. Are you ready for questions on that one?
Yes, I will note certainly in the PowerPoint, and it's also in your detailed packets. Revenues have continued to meet or certainly exceed expectations. You can see the positive growth in blue. It dipped at the beginning of the recession and otherwise has been very, very healthy. There's stability in budgeting and collections because we continue to have very healthy growth in the number of rooms as well as the average of revenue collected per room. You can see the chart on the bottom. We forecast in the future that this will simply continue. Although there is ever-increasing numbers of hotels in Nashville, mm-hmm. There has been no real abating of at least year-over-year revenue growth in this 3 to 5% range, sometimes much more healthy. So we think, being conservative, the baseline sales tax number for next year is going to be around 4%. The baseline figure we're doing for Hotel Motel is around 4%. And I would close with an Hotel Motel, same chart we've had in years past. The number in green is the amount that would be available each year for capital-related projects. Generally, we're thinking parks, tourist-related activities, and those sorts of things. And so the positive story to this is simply that, you're seeing, amounts of well over $1 million a year that would be available for Tier 2 and or beyond capital projects. I don't know if Eric or Christine want to add anything to that.
The only thing I did, just from observing it, our occupancy rates have slipped a little bit, but our room inventory has increased. So we're still kind of holding our own. The revenue per available room has been pretty steady. So generally it's good news. It's just keep an eye on it because there has been such a rush of investment in hotel properties across the region, and we haven't seen a huge impact on us yet, but it still might as there are more options and more competition out there. So it's just something to keep an eye on. We've been pretty conservative in how we estimate this. And again, we don't pay the CVB except for on the actual numbers we received in the prior calendar year. So it's a very, it's a known number. We're never giving them money based on a projection. It is based on what we actually collected in the previous calendar year. So it, that works well, gives them certainty, and we don't get in front of ourselves if something should shift. So it, it, it seems to be working well, but we'll keep an eye on this one just because we know the market's changing.
Didn't we see a little bit of a dip too in A-game close, and we know that's back under contract?
We saw some. It was actually, it seemed to be more in the restaurant business for whatever reason. That's where I heard more, and it's more anecdotal than anything. But that did drive somewhere around, at their peak with tournaments, somewhere around 18,000 hotel rooms a year is what had been estimated that, that A-game helped support. Now, I know there have been some workarounds in the near term, so we may not have lost all of those, but you know, if that can get stabilized, that should help us in
this
area.
And that's
too.
Just been sold, right? Did I just
there,
say
it's under contract,
this week,
I think.
Under contract
I don't know if
this
it's
week.
Officially transferred ownership yet. But
okay.
So it was how many, it affected how many hotel rooms? 18,000.
The estimate we had through the CVB working with the data they had from A-game, it's about a year or two old, but it was, I think, 17,700 and change of attributable room nights to especially tournament activity at A-game.
Well, plus you said the revenue for the restaurants.
Yeah. The restaurant pieces, we've heard anecdotally from especially the owner of the retail area, the restaurants right on Cool Springs, right near A-game. They'd seen somewhere around a 20% drop in some of their restaurant business, and they attributed that a lot of that to A-game. That's just what we've been told. Don't really have hard numbers to support that, but that's the story. So.
Okay. First of all, you were saying that this is a state permitted tax, right? Mm-hmm. Okay. It does not have to go to any specific use, though. I've heard that the county and Brentwood both just put theirs in the general fund.
They do, but there's legislation at the state that would change that, requires it to be used, mm-hmm. at least a certain component of it to be used mm-hmm. for direct activities that support mm-hmm. tourism in the community. Mm-hmm. So that landscape may be shifting. You know, we look at the ways we use it and try to make sure it aligns with things that support tourism, but also look for things that have a general benefit as well. This is a great place for some of the parks projects and components of streetscape we've even targeted mm-hmm. from this funding source, because we think, hey, that's part of the experience of coming downtown, and what attracts people is having that kind of attractive infrastructure. So we do try to use it in a way that both benefits the community overall, but also has an appeal in support of tourism.
Okay, and what about this year? Are we going to get, like, was it 100 or 200,000 more whenever they?
The hotel motel audit.
Oh yeah.
We do have a couple that are under appeal. It's a little under $200,000 of
in total.
And they will be recorded to this fiscal year. And
were they appealing paying it at all, or just the amount that they?
Well, they're appealing the auditor's report. They believe that they have found additional documentation that would allow some exemptions that they had taken that the auditor could not substantiate. So and as you would imagine, these auditors they're actually, it's a different firm than does our external audit. Sure. They're a finishing tax season right now, so I'm trying to be kind. I'm going to get with them next week to see if they've got those done. But certainly the timing, want to let them get through. I think it's April 17th this year mm-hmm. is the day. And mm-hmm. we have just a couple to make sure that there's not any adjustments from the auditors. But that is recorded in fiscal 18. But most of those funds have been collected.
Okay. All right, so I guess whatever we're talking about, not having seen the results of Nashville adding to their rooms and everything, they really haven't, the big things haven't come online yet, have they, in Nashville?
There are several
some,
of them,
but yeah.
Some of them have. Mm-hmm. I mean, there are several downtown hotels which have not, and those are those will be large. But again, there's such a robust tourist market, and business market, as we all know, in and around our region. That you know,
I can see why some small conferences might prefer to be in Franklin. Absolutely. And not downtown. Yes. Nashville there.
Well, I know my professional association, TCMA, used mm-hmm. to do on a rotation a session, spring or fall session in Nashville, and those are off the calendar now. There's no way we can do them, because the last time we did it, we had gotten in before rates changed, but even then it was more pricey than our members wanted to pay, and so now we're not even looking. And so our Middle Tennessee venues are really either going to be Murfreesboro or Franklin.
Yeah.
It's no longer, Nashville's no longer in consideration, just because it's just too expensive.
I know
for the space we use.
The Tennessee municipal judges have met here in Franklin several times. I don't think they're doing it this year, but but they have, just for partly what you said, and also just being able to get out and around, you know, instead of having to be down there. But at any rate, I just kind of wanted to hear what was going on sort of with that right now.
I just have one question.
Sure.
Go ahead, Paul.
Are they coming in parts with the hotel motel fund, and then the in lieu of park fund, will there be any opportunity to, because of the parkland fund in lieu of, or the quadrant that we're talking about, with new development, will that affect this hotel motel fund that we're putting into parks?
I think we have a choice.
It's a funding option.
We don't have to.
Yeah, it's one of your funding options to augment parkland
funding buckets.
Yeah.
Well, actually, there are three.
Yeah,
if you think about the regular facilities tax, it had parks as one of its four main things.
Yeah, and it's all growth and new.
Right, and I think
you're
could
right,
even make a
key.
Case for a portion of county facilities tax, because we have schools using, especially
that's
the athletic fields, and if we're doing lacrosse and rugby, there's school clubs that are very anxious to find space, and some of them use Jim Warren now, but so I think those are all options we'll look at and be part of, kind of just. And what our team does is looks at the different components of those project budgets and looks at the funding source that matches up best. And so Parkland helps with some, Hotel Motel helps with others, things like facilities and county facilities may fill in other areas too.
Well, and now I had just happened to think, since you're saying that, we're saying though that the Parkland won't be for historic parks, right? So they would be more likely to fit in with
largely
hotel that. Motel
yeah.
or something
yeah,
like that.
I would think so.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Interesting. Okay.
Just one. I'm gonna make a brief comment.
Mm-hmm.
1987, when we passed the facilities taxes, we were covered up with people who were saying we were gonna kill growth. The city will dry up. It will become a ghost town.
Yeah.
And this is dating ourselves, because Andy's smiling too. Because Andy sent through it also. We're killing.
I was on the planning commission.
if we have. But anyway, my comment. Do you need to leave?
Yeah, I have another obligation.
Paul has another obligation.
We've got
one other presentation, and we're almost there.
Yeah.
One final fund, and that is the In Lieu of Parkland or Parkland Dedication Fund. Was created in 2015. You are actively discussing modifications to that fund. I'm not going to rehash that. The fund, however, can be used only for the acquisition or development of public parks, greenways, blueways, open space sites, and related facilities. To that end, there is one expense that has hit this fund since its creation. That was $505,402 related to the costs of Robinson.
Yeah, acquiring the Robinson Lake.
We forecast $1.4 million next year. There's possibly upwards of $2 million between various developments that could come. We think the $1.4 million is probably accurate. We thought $2.4 million was accurate this year. We think that'll be closer to $700. So good news at the end of the day. We started with a balance of $4.5 million this year. That will be close to where we end up, we believe, maybe a little higher. There are no expenses forecast in fiscal 19 against this fund at this time. Mm-hmm. Any questions?
Where's the funding for the Southeast Municipal? Has that already been in the capital investment projects?
It's a mix. Yeah, we've looked at Parkland will be a part of it. Facilities will be part of it, and there may be a little bit of general funding in there as well. So that's all.
And to blend. To be clear, we have certainly itemized and stated the expenses and the costs of projects. We have not secured funding, if you will. So we haven't appropriated the funds.
We haven't appropriated it.
But we haven't appropriated funds. Gotcha. We will come back to you in the ensuing months with, again, capital financing model redone. The discussion of future bond issuances will be part of that, as well as what cash amounts we pull from funds like Parkland or facilities. Okay. And speaking of bonds.
Yeah. We save this fund, the fund for the last budget presentation. And on the debt service fund, I will, Mike, I'm sure Michael will assist me, just go ahead and we'll go on page 3.
Mm-hmm.
The debt service fund is where we do account for the expenses for our general obligation debt service. All of our debt service, with the exception of water and sewer, which is recorded into the water and sewer fund and in accordance with accounting rules, is recorded to the debt service fund. The largest revenue source for the debt service fund are our property taxes, which are recorded directly to the debt service fund. We also have revenues that we record as transfers from the sanitation fund. We do have some capital funds, which is the other revenue. But we do, and something I just do want to take a moment to point out, is that we have recorded more property taxes to the debt service fund for fiscal year 18 than we did in 17, because of course we issued a bond issue at the end of fiscal 17 there in June. We did not incur any interest costs for that bond issue until beginning fiscal year 18. So while it appears in the general fund that property tax revenues went down, they actually have in aggregate gone up by $1 million in 18 over 17, because we do record property taxes directly to the debt service fund. So you have to aggregate those to get the true picture of property taxes. So I wanted to point that out, and Mike is a wonderful accountant, and he makes sure he points that out in his reports, but I did want to point that out. This is actually where you see property taxes recorded in addition to the general fund. For fiscal year 19, we have expenses, debt service expenses of $13.8 million, and if Michael will assist and go to the next graph, the next slide is a graph, and this relates, this shows our debt service going out into the future, and I want to make a couple of points about this slide. Fiscal year 19, we're at $13.8 million, just right underneath the $14 million line on the axis. If we stair-step out to 2024, this is where Eric was describing early in our meeting that we have the step-up in debt service. And if you look, if you compare that to where we will be in debt service in 23, that's about $1.5 million jump from 23 to 24. And when Eric was describing how that looks, he was describing that with words, but here's, you can actually see that step up, the $1.5 million.
And you want to say why?
And there were that's how there were some bonds structured years ago that began paying principal in 24. So there's
they hadn't paid a penny of principal.
There's the step, and then as Eric was describing, it starts backing back down. So this is a graph that's in our minds. We see this as we attempt to describe it. Burned into our minds, but as we attempt to describe this to you, this is what you're actually seeing in part. You know, you can see this is what we are thinking about when we talk about this, the debt service going out. Certainly,
The 2015 TIF bonds that we discussed several hours ago are attributed to the Industrial Development Board. They are not included here. So right. When we talk about the
that's
timing,
right. Plus
the 2020, those bonds that were the 2015 TIF bonds, which were anticipated, they're regularly scheduled to pay off in 25. We're now projecting them back off a couple of years. There's that gap. So we wanted to point that out with this
because that
graph.
Would be even right now, but. I've lost it.
Right at $2 million.
That's what
So if we're closer to $3 million,
that would pay off some of these things quicker.
There's that gap that we are picturing in our minds. So I did want to use this as an opportunity to point out what we do as Eric described had burned in our minds. I do want to also make a comment here that. And we do have this in words on the next slide.
Yeah, the next page,
Our capital plan calls for issuing general obligation bonds every other year, beginning 17, 19, and then 21, in the calendar year 17, 19, and 21, so that we do, for projects that are identified as bond-funded projects, we will actually have those funds in the bank and spend those down over a three-year period rather than relying on reimbursements from bond issues once projects are completed. And the next timing of that issuance would be in calendar year 19. And what we certainly, at this point, do not know if that's, what time in calendar year 19 exactly that will be. But we do not anticipate having interest expense in fiscal 19 for the year, fiscal year ending June 30th. Saying. We do have an estimate for cost of issuance, which would be recorded to the fiscal year in which the bonds are closed. So if we close a bond issue in May or June of 19, we would account for those expenses in fiscal 19. So that is incorporated into the budget. But we do not have interest expense for a bond issue in calendar 19 included into fiscal 19. And we certainly will be getting back to this committee with more information as we get closer to looking at what that bond issue would look like and the projects that may be funded in that bond issue, but I did want to take a moment to point that out.
I'd also like to say in your detailed budget,
that's right, that's worth
you have,
looking at.
What we hope is a lot more information. In there, you've got the three ratios on the front page that are part of the debt policy.
Yeah.
And just so you can, this is your adopted policy and the adopted ratios that you've adopted. So we wanted to make sure that you had those now within your budget. So we will update that every year as we update values and the value of the property of the city as well as the amount of debt service. The debt curve, if you will, for all GO bonds that you just saw on the screen is provided as page 4 of your detailed packet. And then page 5, 6, 7, and 8 are the schedules for that debt service for each of those major funds, general, sanitation, hotel motel, and road impact going out for the duration of the debt with which we have to serve, both in a graphical format and in a numeric format. So we're not trying to overwhelm you, but we're trying to certainly be able to give you the detail behind what the future obligations are for the city.
Okay, comment though, the way interest rates are going right now though, I've forgotten what did we get for the interest rate on this last one,
on the 2017 bonds?
Yeah, and then I want to ask about the one before 3%. That.
2.73.
Okay, yeah. And what
that's
was
on,
just under,
on page 5.
Just on,
2.37,
is that what you
said? 2.73.
2.73.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so what do you think it's going to be this time, a year later?
We'll be projecting probably more in the four, certainly, we don't know, we can't look in the future, but we're going to be safe and estimate 4 or 4.5.
Mm-hmm. See,
and
that is a
because we don't
lot
want to over,
of difference.
We don't want to go over
a
that.
A lot of difference mm-hmm. on the interest, which is a huge part of any kind of
but
bond
and one aspect as well is the 17 bond issue, 3/4 of that bond issue with the projects were road projects, and those were amortized as 20-year average life. Mm-hmm. They began paying principal immediately.
Yeah.
We did have a part of that issue was for projects that were shorter in life, including, for instance, a fire truck, and we amortized, while a fire truck has a long life, we certainly did not want to go out 20 years. We amortized that shorter, and with the end of leasing, mm-hmm. that is something that yeah. is in our, as we go through here and the city administrator decides what to propose, there may be aspects of some assets that have shorter lives, and we will amortize those on shorter level debt service. I do think, if I make a comment about what that 19 bond issue may look like, while most of it may continue to be road projects that are 20 years, there may very well be aspects that are amortized shorter, so that the mm-hmm. because of the project itself, it may be maybe a fire truck that is included, for example. So certainly, I think you're going to see that we'll have shorter average lives of bond issues because of the nature of the projects that are included, and specifically as leasing programs have been required to stop.
Because I'm looking back on some of these other things, and they were obviously 30-year, no question about it. Mm-hmm. But also, we still have some variable debt in here.
We do. We do have some variable rate.
That,
and there were some hedges on those, which we have one that's running out here in about 2 years, and another one that goes out longer. But mm-hmm. but we are right now we're comfortable with fixed rate level debt.
Oh yeah,
that is. As short as we can possibly keep mm-hmm. it as well, but be equitable so that we can afford the capital projects that are on our plan. So it's a simpler debt structure, but it's one that we believe is manageable and in the best interest.
Mm-hmm. It is going to mean though that we pay more money.
Ma'am. I would certainly expect that interest fixed rates on our bonds will be higher in 19 yeah. than they were in 17 when we issued the bonds at the end of June last year.
Interesting becomes going up too, right?
Yeah. We have a little bit. Hey,
but
true.
But not as much.
And historically, a 4% interest rate is still pretty darn good.
Oh, gosh. Oh, gosh.
I remember being excited about getting 7 and 8% on money.
That's right.
A number of years ago. So, It's one of those things we always look at and try to do the best job we can in terms of getting money as cheap as possible and looking at all of our options to do that. So that's always part of our strategy.
And at least the tax exemption is still there. We lost on the advanced refundings being taken away for us, but certainly at least we still have a tax exemption to help us, and we need to be glad for, I guess, what we got.
Yeah.
Any other questions on debt service?
Any questions? Do you want to? Do you? Does anyone want to do a specific on any of the monthly reports?
Maybe just kind of highlight one
item. If you look at local sales tax, we had estimated in the budget that it would be a 4.5% increase, and with what we collected in January or for January, we're real close. We're at 4.4%. Mm-hmm. So. It's almost one that we may be right there at right. it, but no, we're still just a little bit less than that.
Well, the challenge was, of course, was that our 17 collections were less than what we had forecasted at this time, because we certainly don't have all of our sales tax numbers until the end of August
That's
for
right.
the year. And we actually would have had growth of over 6%
exactly
to
make
our
it,
budget. So that's why when Michael gave us the revenue projection, or the first blush of revenue projections back in January, he included, what if we had 4.5% or so yep. over the 17 mm-hmm. actuals, or rather than an 18 budget.
Yeah.
And so we once again had the last month we received was a good number for a month. In which collections are lower. We had
right.
January was up significantly, but yet our most important December collections were essentially unchanged.
Yeah,
they were up
right.
a little over 1%. So
yeah, yeah.
We were glad to have a good January,
it's
but we
really,
wish
it's really been
it's
a weird year.
It has,
fluctuating.
Has indeed.
We had really strong July and August,
and then a low September,
and then November was up 10%. So it's just been all over the place. Yeah. There's not been any kind of consistent way to gauge it. So we really have gotten to the point where we sort of look at it in 3 or 4 month chunks and try to say, okay, what does that look like? and it's four-ish.
The only thing is, though, percent. That the ones that were lower were the big months.
Yeah, you know,
I mean, where you were getting so...
November's a good month, but yeah, December's the biggie, and that's right. To only get 1%.
Yeah, and I was thinking of school starting in around September, whenever it was, too, you know.
But you have the tax exempt status.
Well, that's a point.
They're supposed to make us whole on those, but who knows?
Yeah. Gotcha. Okay.
Any other questions? Any other comments?
Glad we started at one.
That's right.
Or five. Yeah. We used to start.
Oh, yeah. We have started at seven.
Yeah. We had some late nights.
Motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
Second. All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
We are adjourned.